figures.
On OKCupid, there's a question that is, how often do you tweet? And like my answer, I feel like I have to put all the time, and like it always gets flagged. It always gets flagged as that like red unacceptable. Like, oh, people didn't like this. Nobody wants to date someone that's into Twitter. I'm like, God fucking damn it. Goddamn millennials.
Is that a Meepo ban? What happened?
Alright, yeah, let's get this
Did
thing
they
going.
Meepo someone?
They must have. Now remember, right. Alliance is out. So
yeah, they're done, though.
They could be doing something a little different here, shaking it up. 10 seconds. Did Secret just beat VP? I actually didn't get the update on that result. Who actually won?
No, they VP won.
VP
with
won.
The VIO timing.
So this is still a big deal for Secret in terms of they need this win.
All right, Secret have not meepoed anyone. But perhaps...
If this is a techies band, and you know, okay, Ricky, we've...
Okay, these yeah, are so they're bands. Kind of clowning. So they're like banning stuff that opens up more stuff in the beginning if you want to talk about it actually tactically. So it's like the better heroes are still left in the pool.
Wow, first pick Skywrath Leshrac. Alright, well, that solves it. Alliance are going to have some fun this game, and I'm ready. Rev up those engines, baby.
Oh, that's so shitty, though. I hate this about these group stages. It's stupid. Like, they're first picking Skywrath Leshrac against a team that, like, now team... I don't know. I think that's dumb.
Do you think... What do you mean? You think it's dumb from, like...
I don't know how... Like, is there... I feel like if you have a smaller group stage, then this kind of scenario just, like, don't happen as much, you know what I mean? Where it's, like...
Well,
yeah, there's more tiebreakers and shit sometimes, but at least you don't have so many of these games where people just...
It happens less, because in the big group stage, it's just... There's way more variance in terms
yeah,
of the order in which you play
so
teams.
Early.
So there is, like, if it's a 16-team group stage or a 12-team group stage, it stands to reason that one of the lower teams could have, like, a hell day one where they play the top five seeded teams in the
right,
tournament
exactly.
that are in the group. So yeah. if they lose their first six games, they're mathematically eliminated. That is definitely mitigated by having more groups of less teams, 100%. It's not totally gone, but... It's less of a factor. So I agree with you there. That's one of the drawbacks to this. But the big benefit, Trent, we get to see every team play each other. And when you have two
That's
groups,
true.
Sometimes you don't get to see every matchup. So like most things in life, there's drawbacks and benefits. Yin and yang, if you will.
Well, they don't want the people happening. So I suppose at least that's gone. What's left in the pool here first? Secret. I wonder if we'll get like a Forev Tiny. Probably just gonna be Forev Slider, I reckon. Slider is not really a hero that I'm familiar with Secret playing a lot though, now that I think about it, and I'm just looking over their drafts. They have picked a first phase with like Drow before, who's also still in the pool, by the way. So Secret might just go Drow.
Yeah, I like the
then
Omni
again,
Knight. Then
again, so might Alliance.
Maybe. I think Alliance are going to go crazy magic damage.
This
like,
is some complexity shit today. With two of the call boys, Limp and Hanskin. Like, complexity used to run
shit.
This like Leshrac stuff quite a bit.
I wonder what the build is on Leshrac right now. Like, if it's Limp, Lesh, Mid, for example.
I think it's just, like, Bloodstone, Octarine still.
No, skill build, I mean. Like, is Lightning good now? I'm not sure. Because the build for a long time when he was broken was, it's, like, all about Lightning, and he gets stunned. Edict has a long cast point. It's kind of poopy. Value point, whatever. Lightning is so dumpy right now. Okay, Magnus. Is that a Jonas Magnus?
Did S4 sub in? It's going...
I don't think Limp really plays Magnus. I'm not mistaken. I think it's probably off lane for Jonas. That's my guess. Or it's low to safe lane. But again, I don't think it's a low to hero either.
Do you mind? I'm trying to survive over here, dude. You're just throwing low to safe lane Magnus at me?
Hey, man. They love the safe lane blink dagger carriers. I didn't mean to say that so weird, but blink dagger carriers. You know? Safe lane Centaur, safe lane Slardar. Magnus fits the bill. That's a load of hero, dude.
You're not wrong, honestly. The mentality's there. Yeah, there we go. Mic stand fully adjusted. Schwen stands ready. Okay, this is more normal looking heroes. Magnus Sven, excellent combination. Good damage. Good life. Probably Magnus. Yeah, I really think it's. I think it's gonna be mid. I'm sure Limp's just gonna play it.
You think Limp's gonna play Magnus mid?
Yeah, I think it's a core Leshrac in the offlane.
I think it's a core Leshrac mid offlane Magnus, and I will bet you a whole Snickers. Okay.
That's a good deal.
Yep. Sorry. This is serious. Shouldn't be laughing.
Hey, they did Pudge. Would you look at that?
Alrighty!
Pudge-ka.
So...
Squishy Skywrath, Squishy Leshrac.
Support, yeah, this is actually not a bad Pudge game. I like it.
You would have expected it from Alliance in some ways.
Oh, and
Pudge
isn't against...
really the clown hero anymore, though, to be honest.
No, it's really not. And it's pretty good against Sven, too, I think. You know, having a Dismember to eat him while he's in the ult form, you know, gives you some really good lockdown for that big bad boy. Goes through BKB. There's some cool stuff there.
Oh, so baby. They need one more support. Oh no. Slardar, Pudge, two melees, Luna, low attack range, Shadow Demon. Are Alliance gonna techies? Last pick. Do you think Secret ban it? I bet they do. I would ban techies. Just because they have the Magnus. I think it's offlane Leshrac move style. I think they would do stupid ass shit.
You know, it's actually not the worst idea at this point. I feel like they are going to have a pocket fifth pick that's going to make the whole thing come together. We're going to go, okay.
Ban the techies. Secret. Don't fall into this trap.
I want to see a battle techies,
To be fair, techies would really get me woken up right now. I'm already pretty awake just watching this, starting to think about techies and getting a little bit angry inside of Secret. Don't ban it.
Battle techies, Trent. Suicide level 1. Rush the blink dagger. It's the shit.
What's the best hero that's not techies, though?
Well, it's hard to say, but they probably want a support.
Yeah, exactly. That's what techies is.
Yeah.
I think it's a position 4 hero.
I'm trying to think of other position 4s, though.
I guess it could be 5, because like Skywrath's going to be really busy harassing top with the Leshrac, which I think is what's happening. So it's like someone who chills with Sven.
Sand King. Okay, I like that. I think Alliance is going to pick somebody that does a lot of magic damage. Like, it seems like I'm feeling it, man. They're going to get like Roman Quaff or something. They're going to do some real complexity shit.
There's also the distinct possibility that this is just 4 and 5 Leshrac Skywrath. The only reason I say Leshrac core is that I know Moo's been running it a lot, and I assume they still kind of talk between like complexity and shit. And like,
I also think support Lesh is particularly ass.
No, but it's really good with Sven, right? That was like how it started. Because you set
it's
up with the really long stun time of Hammer. Well, you can't stun a hero to the offlane if they have support Leshrac and Sven. It will die.
Yeah.
That is the one thing. And then you just roam mid with Leshrac and Skywrath Mage, and you just have a mid lane that can set up.
Yeah, I guess it can work. It's just so unreliable, and Lightning is so poopy now. You're basically just a stun. If you don't hit that stun, you're... Like, that combo is cute in lane, but that doesn't win you a game, necessarily. And support Lesh in teamfights is... underwhelming? What does Secret want here, though?
Mid laner? Slider. Yeah, I think so.
Something mobile?
Mid one hero. Ember.
Ember, yeah, it could work.
Flame Guard.
Something with a little AoE.
Burst it pretty fast, but the silence from Skywrath Mage makes that kind of scary.
Yeah, I guess Quaff against Skywrath is
jug mid.
Scary.
It's pretty safe. But then you're jugging to Sven. That's not good. This is interesting.
So is it a Pylai die tiny and mid Pudge?
I think it's a Ferev Tiny. I think it's a mid Luna and a safe lane Slaughter. That's what I'm going with. I don't know, Fred plays a lot of Tiny, but maybe they're just going to do more normal stuff.
Actually, really don't know. It's kind of odd.
It'll probably be Fred Tiny, because he has been playing a lot for Secret. But watching their games is interesting. Dire side, you can do the pull, so he plays it off lane. You can just throw the higher camp into it, pull back the wave, get decent last hits. But it's really easily countered if you're expecting it from the side of the lines. You just run up and block the camp. They have good roamers and Leshrac and Skywrath Mage. So you assume now that if they're going to try that kind of cheeky stuff, you want the tri lane bottom, so you make it support Skywrath Leshrac, I think, for sure. You send the Magnus mid, defense spot, and you pick an offlaner. Or you techies, obviously, but assuming they're not techies. What's their offlane that's left? Void is not that good here. Darkseer is okay. I mean, giant Wombo combo, but not the best Iron Shell friends. Do you have any particular offlaners you like? No, Void's banned anyway.
No, because it's going to be Magnus offlane.
Oh, it's Jonas, so they can just axe too. Oh, right, sorry. It's Magnus offlane. Oh, fuck you.
It's going to be Magnus offlane!
That's a Snickers, so Montreal's coming, buddy. Looking forward to it.
Yeah, love candy. As I already explained to you, there's no Snickers here.
Oh, fuck. All right, I'm going to bring a Snickers, give it to you so you can give it back to me. You know what? This was a gifted Snickers. Double gifted, in fact. Offlane Magnus. It is, however, support Leshrac. So we were both right in a way, in our very own separate ways. Kind of cool. Offlane Magnus, definitely a little bit risky. I'm excited to see what Jonas does. Like, can Magnus go Iron Talon? Like, I want to say yes. I don't see any reason why he couldn't if the lane is, like, unbearable.
I really think they should have just techies once that Tiny got picked. They would have had Pylite Eye to kill wards. Or rather, to kill mines. That was it. Disappoint me, the Alliance. Come on, man.
So you're going to pick...
then again, I'm the one who's flaming them for throwing games. But, I mean, if you're going to throw a game with a Meepo ban, you just...
So you're going to pick DP again here for number two? Or what do you have in mind?
Oh, yeah, these things. Oh, lol. Yeah, nice one. Smoke kills zero. Magic appear.
15 denies.
Game end.
Is that Luna? Who's going to deny a lot? Loda, probably. Loda likes to deny equilibrium. Packet loss. Ooh. Where'd my packet go? 0 to 5. The number four is so stupid. It's like almost always 0 to 500 unless you have a PA. I guess Sven is like one of those heroes that could potentially get a massive crit. This one's like kind of dumb. It's almost always zero until it gets just like kind of random on how long you think the game's going to be.
Yeah, these are all kind of stupid, honestly.
Are you going to go over 500?
Physical damage a hero will do to another in one hit.
Like
yeah.
This goes
Yeah,
late,
I'm going
Sven.
750.
Okay.
I think, yeah, sure, why not?
Is this going to be a long game, denies? Or are they going to get run over? I'm going to go 0 to 500. I'm staying true to the course.
Oh, secret.
So, it's not going to be the Ferev Tiny. We don't get the fun stuff. I thought maybe just because the game... Well, I guess it still matters a lot to Secret, so they're not really going to be throwing or anything, but it's more
pudge.
Normal stuff. Mid one, mid on the Tiny. Get the next
Pudgy
levels.
Puppy.
Aggro, Tri-Lane, Luna.
All right. I Lie Die, Shadow Demon. Tiny headed mid here. Poor man's shield. Interesting. Secret hungry for some early aggression. It looks like they won't find too much of it.
Yeah.
He dancing?
Oh, he almost got hooked.
With a Slardar next to him, that actually would have been pretty scary.
Yeah.
Okay. All good. Let's check out these Lesh cosmetics. Let's check it out, EGM. Pretty sick. Highlight die. It's all about that weapon. Do you remember when they added weapons for Lesh? Like, that was a whole
man.
Thing. He used to just
I remember
have hands.
RTZ was, like, psyched.
Oh, no. Puppy. They found him in Roche.
I mean, he's a Pudge, though. Well, then again, he is level 1 hook.
Yeah, he's in a little sticky wicket. Ally dies on his way in. Hanskin. I think they want to chase this. They'll get as much damage as they can. Wow, EGM finds the stun, oh, but nice now hook. The hook from Puppy. This could go the other way. Tower starting to fly through, but Puppy getting low from Hanskin. Now the stun
turn
from Loda.
Stun.
Pylai die. He will die first. Loda gets the first blood on Sven after that long sequence. And MP, Ruh-roh.
Those are some stairs.
That's
nice,
going to be fine. Another stun. Hanskin, is he going to get these auto attacks off? He's got him.
All right, he's not fine.
Trent, go get some more coffee, my friend.
Oh, interesting. Interesting. So
what a weird sequence.
Sports. I mean, with the setup stun from Sven, though, like, we haven't even had to see that yet. That was just, like, running down steps and stuff for easy Leshrac stuns.
That was also, like, you know, first Skywrath Mana Pool Extreme Harass. Like, they just took way too much damage there. Puppy tried to be sneaky. They caught him.
Well, that's
unfortunate
goodness.
For the Dire. First blood for Loda. Come on, Loader.
So, Pudges is just denying.
Suicidal.
Right. Let's go back to this DP pick, by the way, because... Love the secret tiny. I think they might have been considering it still, but once you have the DP, it was a smart pick from Alliance because they saw the fact that like they could match this up in any way that they're gonna get a win in the mid lane, basically like no matter what with what they do. DP can dominate any melee person or Luna, so they were guaranteed to get something really nice in the mid, either mid Luna or mid tiny. So Limp's gonna have a good time, gonna help them snowball, and honestly with that coming out, I think Alliance have the stronger draft.
Yeah, Limp's dominating pretty hard. Mid one actually just got creep blocked a little bit there, and Skywrath finds the kill on Shadow Demon. Might be on that one, sorry.
It's just like with aggro Luna, like if they get the first blood, it can look so much better for the Dire right now. It's just like...
Yeah, and I think the other thing is up top, you've got Magnus and Slardar trading evenly. Scary on both sides, but I think for Magnus, his farm early on is a little more delicate. For Slardar, he can reliably get Iron Talon, head into the jungle. We've seen it a lot. Magnus, if he has a good lane, that's usually a sign that he's going to be able to transition into the mid game pretty effectively. He also needs experience, all this kind of stuff. And putting him in the off lane, there's a lot of power on that hero getting this kind of space. So these are three lanes now for Alliance that look pretty solid.
Yeah, it's nothing better than being versus a melee hero as Magnus. It's fantastic.
Yeah.
Yo, Jonas is doing some Quelling Blade dropping. Look at this badass.
Hold on, down bottom. Nice defensive hook from Puppy. Keeps MP alive.
Yeah, but who cares about that when this guy's like dropping Quelling Blades for last hits? You see what I mean? Like, this guy is a player.
Why is he dropping his Quelling Blade?
Because of the damage underneath tower. If he doesn't drop it, then it doesn't sync up right.
Yeah, okay.
Because he's a boss, guys.
Jonas has been playing for a pretty long time, man. I remember him vividly from when I, like, the first tournament I cast in Han in, like, 2011. He is kind of
still
an OG.
Still trucking.
Yeah, man.
Oh, look. Pudge denied to a Nutra Creep. Wow.
So, I haven't really been paying attention to Puppy, but has he basically just been farming, finishing off his HP pool, buying stuff, and then just rinse and repeat? Uh-oh, Hanskin. Pylai die going at it. Who wins this duel? Looks like it'll be the Dire. MP joining the party, but now Loda is here. He's got the stun. It's another long sequence. MP out of mana. Hanskin out of mana as well. No. Okay,
all right, EGM.
Stick charges. EGM finds the stun. He clips him. EGM, what a hero. The kobolds, though, the true heroes. Give him the whips. The real kobold challenge. Okay, well, another strange sequence that really just ends well for the neutral. This has been a great game for the neutrals. Let's just look at what's going on here.
Yeah, how many deaths are there total? 3, 5, 7. So 4 deaths to neutrals so far this game. Top lane, Jonas.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. MP rotation.
Rotation comes up. A weird game so far. All right, let's take a look. Overall net worth, Radiant are still super far ahead. What we described in the lanes is still pretty much transpiring. They will rotate now, however, mid lane. Limp takes a combo for mid one, but he's got the Spirit Siphon on. Level 6, no point in the Exorcism. Pretty standard these days. Really not pushing down towers quite this early.
It's doubling up on him in last sets, though.
Yep. I think that is fairly expected. A tough lane matchup. Jonas halfway through 5?
Yeah, man, this is fine. Like, Luna's up here, but he can bully the Luna if he has to. Like, if Luna tries to get aggressive, he's just gonna give you the skewer, right? Give you a couple shockwaves. Yeah, once he gets RP, Luna can't even come near the wave. This is questionable. Shadow needs to get up here.
Also, support's starting to grow a disparity here. Pudge only level 2, Shadow Demon only level 2, both Radiant supports level 3. Those early levels make all the difference in the world, especially for a hero like Pudge. You know, hook significantly better as you start to level it up. Rocky stuff for Secret.
Ha! Ha ha! Were you looking at mid one when you said that or no?
Nope. Just thinking about the mountains. But, you know, I'm in the Rockies after all, man. Come on
now.
That's
true. Yeah.
Mid off the mark. Go, oh, no.
I mean, was that? I mean, he's still level 2.
Yeah.
I'm not even sure that would have been very good.
Yeah, come to think, I mean, mid one was behind him, but mid one's still only level 6. I don't know if they can burst down Limp, who also has a haste rune. They definitely can't burst him down with...
Yep. No gold for
Limp. With the infused raindrops.
So, mid one, again, not getting any last hits here. 500 gold behind the DP.
Yo, Jonas is hungry, though. He's pissed. He's coming. They see him.
RP.
Oh, no. Nada. Oh, that's unfortunate.
I assume he'll still go Blink first. Leshrac, Skywrath Mage, even DP.
I think so.
Pretty squishy.
Yeah, now that's a really good setup item. It also takes some pressure off the Sven to maybe go for an early Blink Dagger. I mean, Loda's going to go Armlet, probably HOD. Could also just be Treads HOD. Not sure if he wants Armlet. I think likely.
But I think it's Loda Armlet.
Yeah, if you go Armlet, HOD, Echo Saber, Blink on Sven, once you get all those items, you have this window where you're a machine, man.
It would let him capitalize on the RPs a lot earlier in the game.
Yeah.
By going for the Armlet instead. Like, it's way more early damage than the Echo Saber build.
Yeah, I think this is a game where Loda definitely wants to focus on slightly earlier game items. That's why HOD is so
bottom.
Good. EGM down bottom. Yap gets bursted down. Hanskin nearby. Can't do anything to keep his friend alive. And Frev going to try to chase him down. Slardar. He's Slither and he's got Sprint on. Crush on the way, but no. Silence just in time. Now a TP from Jonas looking for a counter kill. Sprint up in about 1, but it's only level 1. Kill those kobolds.
Okay. They have the toss into RP. Or sorry, into stun.
Here it is.
Into the RP.
And Jonas will fall before he can even RP. Hanskin, he does not have any armor. He needs to be careful here. EGM cruising in. That is a level 2 edict. No points in the lightning. He's got a stun. Maybe they can find it. Tosses Limp back. Hits him with a combo, but he's got raindrops. He'll survive through it. Now mid one getting low. A few more auto attacks, so they should be able to bring him down. Oh. He's dead. Now Ferev on the other side. Crush not going to be enough here. Spirit Siphon slowing him down. It's Alliance coming out big. They trade Magnus for 2.
Man, nice little trade though. I mean, the Magnus was already like at a decent spot. It's not like he was like way behind and being punished here. His levels are still fine considering he's off lane.
Yep, he's already got his arcane boots, minimal losses. A little space up top to NP, but
hurts the blink timing on the Tiny a lot too, as well as the Slayer for that matter.
Mm-hmm. And also, the two big cores of Alliance are the ones that really benefited. Now the Sven and the DP are the two that are kind of pulling ahead from the rest of the pack, which is also scary. Two heroes that are hard to deal with when they have early momentum, suffice it to say.
And well, EGM's about to hit level 6. They have the armlet now done. Loda's ready to fight. I mean, this isn't your farming build.
It's true.
It's for certain.
Yeah, HOD first, definitely more farm oriented. Armlet blink. I could be into it. Armlet blink echo. Something like that.
I think, probably more than likely.
Really like the Echo Saber on Sven. But one of the big reasons we were talking about before with, it is interesting though, he went Armlet and Max Cleave, which is the farming build, of course. The best of both worlds. Ferev, maybe too deep down bottom, dives past the tower, concussive. EGM looking for a potential stun. Come on, Lesh. Ponyboy, he's getting juked. Ferev hits him with a stun himself, but now Sven, he's here. He sets it up. Pow! Right in the kisser. Now mid one. Some AoE damage. They'll get the first kill. Puppy inbound.
The save!
Connects on Hanskin. Beautifully done. It's a 2-0 the other way. Alliance.
What a player.
Looking so good all of a sudden. Great coordination. Hanskin, the hero that mattered there for sure.
Yeah. He's about to go his arcane boots too. Keep this push going.
Huge!
Huge! That's huge. Giannis the Fan's getting a little bit of space up top here, killing some creeps. He's gained about 500 gold up here, just chilling next to Shadow Demon and Luna. They have Eclipse though, so he needs to be cautious. But look at this. He's like, I got RP. You want to go? Huh?
He's good, man. He's ready to rumble. He ain't scared. Slimp going for Yules this game. Nope, gonna pick up the drums. Tread drum. Okay.
Yo mama's so fat, it takes 5 warlocks to summon her.
Oh! Yeah, that's a good slam. It takes 5 warlocks.
That hurts.
Oh boy. Shadow Demon, set up.
I mean, is
he's
it,
in. Oh. Jonas taking a lot of burst damage. There he is. He's dead. In comes Limp. He's got some friends inbound. Pylai Dai will pay for his insolence. Any more? Nope. MP mid one. Gonna make it out. So they go 1-for-1. A lot of TP. Support for 4. Not ideal, but hey, this is Space Creator for Loader. Look at this. He's loading them up, and he's killing them down.
Nice big manual stack. No help required.
Hey, man. It works. Look at that. They just earn him up. They smoke immediately. He's going Echo Saber. It's like... Pops on the high ground, mid one, good position. Some stacks here for Secret as well. Puppy, level 5. The pretty decent range on Hook. Good positioning here. Defensive Hook to try and save mid one, but is it going to be enough? It might not be. EGM, Pony Boy. Catches up, and he's got the damage. You know, I have to say here, Trent, this support Lesh so far has been pretty impressive. EGM's been killing it.
Yeah, he's been nailing the stuns.
That is the key aspect.
Oh, YOLO.
No.
I half expect them to do it, but I'm not even sure they knew the Luna was there. Obviously, they did. Yeah, they knew that she was still at the tower, I should say. Probably just thought she TP'd out already.
Man, I am really glad he's doing this build, though. I'm glad he's not getting Lightning Storm. Like, I don't know if you've played Lesh recently, but it's just... It doesn't feel worth the mana cost.
Well, especially on support.
200 just, damage. Yeah,
it's much more important with this armlet and shit to have the edict going for tower pushing.
Right. And of course, leveling up the stun is great for the bigger radius and all that good stuff.
Look how he's holding it, though. He doesn't have that much mana, and like they're already pushing in. They're using the exorcism. This way, they key his mana to actually stun to play in.
Support Lesh reminds me a little bit of like a support Windranger. You know, if you're really good at shackles and you can just max shackle and keep landing them, you're probably a bitch in support. Same deal with Lesh. If you can land those stuns, like, you're killing it. That is a big if, though.
Yeah. Well, double tower gold now, pumping on into these guys. Jonas and Fan getting up into his Blink Dagger. Blink Dagger picked up on the dire side of the Slardar. And a tiny 500 gold away from his own. So their own momentum-based rolling lineup between Slardar and Tiny is behind. Tiny's at 3,800 gold. I mean, he's 300 gold ahead of a Magnus. Game sucks.
Tiny got shut down. This is, yeah, it does feel like.
I mean, they threw
Tiny.
Him. That's why I thought it was gonna be offlane, because like they threw him mid, but then the DP comes out and it's like, well, we can't throw our Luna into that.
Yeah, so. You have to sacrifice somebody. At least Tiny can still do some burst damage without
crush
farm.
On the Loda, but lol.
Rev shows off the Blink Dagger. Puppy shows off that sick creep hook.
Barely does damage.
This is brutal. Sionis close to Blink. Yeah, 1700, not too far.
Loda, back in Ancients. They have vision of him, doesn't even care.
Stun on Rev, he's dead. That's what happens when Slardar stands there. EGM hooked, instant silence on Puppy. Well done with Limp, and EGM will be fine. And again, space created for Loda.
Yeah, just more urns. Pressure keeps going. Mid one, he's getting a lot of room down bottom. He is getting up into his own Blink, but similarly up top, Jonas Man doing the same thing. Clears out camp, medium camp, and
Blink is great on Tiny, but a lot of it is the timing. And at 15 minutes, I feel like some of the threat is neutralized.
Yeah, he'll be level 9, so he'll be level 10. He does 1,000 damage right now if he blinks and does his full combo and 2 right clicks on you.
So Lesh is not a full combo. Well,
Magnus is close.
BP's good, Sven is good. Obviously, Skywrath is the weak one that he'll try to pick on. But, yeah, you know, if you got this 5 minutes earlier, 3 minutes earlier, before EGM gets this Vitality Booster, for example, you could probably find some pickoffs there. This item definitely gets a little bit less valuable the later you pick it up at this stage.
I mean, look at the items they're building, too. Like, The Death Prophet has the Vit Booster and an Ogre Club. So she's just getting raw survivability up against the tiny Blink.
Mm-hmm.
I know it's really the only way they die. It's all just magic.
So and now sustainability up on Sven. Yeah, everybody's building pretty tanky here.
There's also a real big lack of synergy there between the Tiny and the Slaughter, because you're like blinking all this magic damage, but it doesn't do anything for the minus armor. Then again, I mean, his right clicks are decent, you get two of them off, but...
And it's still double stun, though. I mean, Slaughter has some burst damage. It's not magic.
Yeah, no, I just mean, like, the amp, though. Like, doesn't really help out Tiny
It's
spells.
Not the most synergy, but still, between the two of them, with all that spell damage and then the right clicks, it's still pretty dirty. I mean, I'll take it.
Always dirt. Smoke Posse on Skyrath, they know they're in.
Rev, the one Puppy. That takes the first bit of damage. Hook does connect on EGM. He gets comboed. Goodnight, sweet flesh rack. Up top, Jonas, RP on two. You are down.
Stun on Sven.
Here we go. That's the setup. Now Luna pops the Eclipse. Loda hooked up to the high ground. Puppy eats it, but it's too little, too late. Puppy won't even find the kill. Exorcism deployed at the end. It's a 2-for-3. Where did Sven die? Oh, Shadow Demon poison. Must be. Okay, so ends up surprisingly good for Secret. 3-for-2, they still trade even in net worth.
Wow, yeah, I did not realize. Pilot Eye God. 851 gold, unfortunately going to the Shadow Demon.
I thought Sven was good. Like, clear, I mean, you know.
Yeah.
Good in the fight. Loda is about to have Blink, though, so those kind of situations get a little easier. That
bottom
RP
lane?
From Jonas, was that blind?
I think he had the vision from
disruption.
EGM dying, right?
Oh yeah, EGM was up there. Okay. It was like a really good effort at a huge RP. It was good positioning from Secret being kind of spread all around this area. We still managed to catch two, but it could have been a lot worse. Also, kind of a strange build from Jonas. He's gone for maxed out in power instead of points and skewer.
Yeah, this is just because he's the Sven armlet, right? Like if you're not going to go max in power, then he would have built more common items, I think, like the Helm of Dominion.
What do you mean?
Stuff.
Like, if you don't go max...
If you don't max in power, you build Helm to, like,
so you're
do
saying
more
because
stacks
Sven
and...
went a fighting build, the idea is you just get the buff so Sven does maximum damage as
soon
as possible.
Yeah.
Okay.
Like, I don't think his skewers are as important. Gotcha. I've seen a lot of people, like, as long as you have a half-decent in power, a lot of people are maxing this anyway. It used to be 2 points in skewer first, but most mags that I've seen at least lately are just going for the one.
Okay. Yeah, and that second point doubles the damage. The biggest... Well, it's a...
That's the best value.
Jump.
Yeah.
The distance,
percentage
course,
nice,
difference.
But... Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, the distance scale's okay. It's one of those ones where you really feel the difference between 900 and 1200, but you don't feel the individual jumps nearly as hard. Little illusion harass here. Surprise, surprise. Is that a dire scan? Yep. Loda hungry? Ghost Saber, what an item.
Echo Saber Sven, Echo Saber Tiny, Echo Saber Empowered Sven, pretty good. Pow pow. Pow pow pow. Doesn't even have his treads yet, dude. Who needs
BK
attack speed?
B on limp. This is a cool build. He just went casual Vit Booster into BKB. Probably mostly for the Tiny.
Yeah.
To survive the burst. You know, also compensate for like the extra Slardar stun that could maybe follow up.
It's like you live through the burst and then you get like pop your BKBs that come in with the Eclipse and your ulti's going and then your BKB lets you survive the whole duration.
Isn't there synergy though with the amp damage and then the Echo Saber on Tiny? Because he hits so hard like physical wise. That's part of
the
burst.
Once that gets going there, it's there. I just mean like that early state.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's super early like roaming duo.
We will have the Echo Saber soon though.
Easy tower here for the Radiance. Alliance looking like they want to wrap around, but they're only three in this little... Secret looking like they want to wrap around, but only is three.
Yeah, this is a little bit odd.
Not sure what the play is
here. TP in the Luna? Yeah, she's TP.
They're going to find Jonas. He TP's back, but now the jig is up. The Blink's back. EGM now stunned. They're still completely split. There's no Luna with them. It's 4v5, and they have to get back. Puppy reveals himself.
They
ping.
Man.
Loda on the hunt. They might still find him.
Right,
well done by Puppy.
Out.
Moves into the fog. I feel like that was high risk and mid-tier rewards.
And now their Luna's dead.
Yeah.
Didn't see the TP. Oh, anyone? Never mind. She's good.
Oh, a TGM, unfortunately. Magnus probably could have stopped it. Okay, that works out better than it should have for Secret. For Rev now, he's the one that's going to get left behind. Mystic Flare for the stun from Sven. Very easy. Nice synergy there. Well done, Alliance.
Oh, mid one's pushing bottom, getting his Equisaber, but get the kill mid, can push into the tower, have Exorcism, have everything available on the Radiant side, still have RP, 1800 gold on top. We had our Tread Equisaber Magnus the other day, that was pretty cool, but didn't end up working.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the Dendi. Yeah, I don't know if it's a coincidence that that build was also on the team that got dead last in the group stage.
Yeah.
Brutal. Brutality, man. It was still cool. If you're balling mid on a Magnus, there is some legitimacy to going Tread's Echo Saber. But you gotta carry pretty hard. Puts a lot of pressure on yourself, you know? Sven is just cleaving all day, man. And no blink on Loda. I guess feeling like they've already got enough initiation.
Nice, he's got
just
it.
Going right for the BKB. Oh, put him. Oh my god, dude, I'm blind. He's going into BKB after blink. Very smart build. Fast blink back. That was a good reaction. Oh, it's catching up with me, Trent. We've got
I know.
Two or three games after this.
We're 8 games in, guys. I'm sorry.
We're 8 games into the 22 game. No, what is this? 19 out of 22 overall? Something like that. I've lost track.
What's up with Loda? No treads.
I think he's holding out for BOTs, man. The bots. What does he need treads for?
I don't know, the in-between Equisaber hits?
Like, good. I mean, look how fast they're blowing people up, dude.
He finds a DD rune, it's fine. Who needs anything else in life?
I mean, honestly, right now the Alliance strategy has been just catch him with a stun and then blow him up with magic damage. The Loda auto attacks have kind of been tertiary to the rest of the plan.
His BKB's done, dude. They have double 10-second BKB. They can just go take Roche, not even have to worry about a fight.
And a gem, too. They are ready to command and conquer. DP now has a plate mail, so she's extra tanky. Here we go.
All right, how do they win this game is Secret, because I think they might have lost. The two super farm cores, they're about to run at you. You have no towers left. Forev has to crush the Skywrath.
Any big items. Luna almost has Manta. Maybe you wait for that. And then I think you need Forev, and you need mid one working together, the mobile death squad. You need to find a pick off, and then you need the best goddamn Slytherin crushes you've ever seen.
There's the Roche.
I think that's a step. Contesting this Roche could be a step.
They know they're in.
They've got a good team for it. You've got Pudge who can isolate people out. You've got a good AoE stun. Luna's great around the pit. Secret are starting to move in. I think this is the right call. They've got to do something. They can't just hand this over. Like, Aegis on Loda is like borderline GG territory. They just go high ground.
I already have this ward, though. Now there's the smoke. All right, that's huge. They know this ward's going to be up there. Oh, here we go.
Again, they're a little bit split, though.
Oh, DP.
There's the hook. DP gets off the BKB, though. They turn it the other way. Now Loda comes out. They destroy the Slardar. He don't need no treads to find these kills. Mid one brought down by the mighty Rogue Knight. Back to Roche we go. Mid tier one tower falls. Secret at least get something for it. But I'm more, why didn't they contest this 5? They did this 2+3 thing again, and it got him a tier 1 tower mid, but at a pretty hefty cost, to be frank.
Yeah, I don't know, it's kind of weird. It's like they're really playing 2 and 3.
If you're split pushing for a tier 3, I could see that, but I mean, a tier 1 versus Roche is kind of...
Yeah. Yeah. 35 seconds on BKBs, and then, like, do you just go high ground? Are you 1400 gold on Sven? So you can spend that first. Some middle of the pack items. We still need our Yules. Being down here on EGM.
Hey, hey. The smokes. We're learning. 3 blink daggers on Dire. Pylai dies, managed to pick one up. That's kind of cool. I don't know if it's going to really change much here. But yeah, I think you can pretty much just high ground now. Like, Limp, how close is he to the next big item? Not that close.
I think AC he's going to go. Yeah, I don't think he's going to go for the Lotus Orb. I think it's just the casual bit booster.
Yeah, agreed.
Oh, sorry. No, well, that's a booster anyway. So that's not even right. So.
Why golly.
Can we just say that, like, why is it red in the middle of the Lotus Orb when it's the blue circle? Can we at least agree on that?
Yes. I mean, I don't see colors, but
thank
yes.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. Yes. Like, clearly.
Yeah, it'll probably build into a heart or an Octarine for Limp. Octarine, I guess, more likely. The illusion shall be pounded. Pound it.
All right, Alliance, let's get some sugar in the gas tank here. Let's pump it up. Pump up the Nikes, boys. Come on now.
Keep laser up. Rev's cutting waves. Or sorry, mid one. Definitely the play. So they all have right. One wave to work with and not that many creeps. Oh no, they found MP.
They
I believe
him.
He might be Dunzo.
He's got jewels. That BGM sets it up. BKB
oh, the Manta!
From Loda.
That was cool. Sweet.
It was cool.
Props, right?
But they still got him. I mean, yeah, you get fist pumped through the screen, bro. But too little, too late. And they'll just go back to defend mid, push it on back, and they got 40 seconds of no Luna. No Lunar.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Well, Loda and crew just kind of took this one by the balls.
Yep.
They said,
Octarine
hey,
core
let's
coming
just
on
grab Skywrath, Lesserac first. Fight us.
Yep. Sometimes you gotta hump it into submission.
How do they just ban Nepo first like that?
And then Ricky. EGM gets hooked. Yules buys him a little time. Whip. Now used by the Dire. EGM gets force stabbed out. Sharing is caring. They'll keep him alive. Luna now respawns. Alliance back out with three. Set for Rev. Misses the crush. And now they might be thinking about a reinitiation. MP caught by the RP. No skewer. There it is. They'll get the kill on Luna. And she's down for another 50. Nicely done. Loda barely lives. And Limp will have a little bit of duration left on his ult as they reinitiate here. Oh, that's Loda's Aegis. Okay. Well, that's all right. They still get the tower. And there's no glyph. But they need to be careful when getting hooked into tier 4 towers. That's scary stuff.
Why
BKB
did
on Loda.
Pilot Eye just goofed.
That was 8-second BKB, but that's all right. They get the melee barracks. I'm not sure if Secret can really win this one without Alliance doing some kind of crazy throw. Once Limp has Octarine, this gets so difficult.
Yeah, I'm kind of surprised he's even going for the Octarine. I thought maybe just because, like, obviously he picked up a casual plate mail, but it's one of those games where, like, are they even going to get the value out of Octarine core? You know?
Yeah, it's
supposed to get
point.
The double heal bonus. It's not just about the cooldown, the ultimate. That's why the item synergizes so well with the hero. But Limp hands off the bottle to give the DD to Loda some Eternal Envy tactics, stolen back from the old No Tidehunter days.
Here we go.
And they might get themselves a nice little pick because of it. Dire had no vision. They have no idea where they are. Puppy is definitely the feeder, like being like, "Come on in, guys." Oh look, they got tricked. By an illusion.
Oh no. Well, that's a bummer. Loader playing a little Doter in the top lane. There is an Octarine so close though on DP.
Yep. It's the next item here. The Shadow Blade on the Magnus. Also excellent.
Yep. He's also carrying the gem. Bought by Limp. As purchased by Limp. Loda. Double damage. The game-winning rune. What are we on the buyback status? This is a 14k net worth lead, by the way.
No buyback. Okay. No important buybacks. The core
got
none of
them. Punch and Shadow Beam. I think that's it.
Yeah.
No glyph, which might be a bigger problem. Crush from Slardar. Hook now from Puppy, but instant BKB from Loda. Doesn't even use the dismember. They'll just focus on objectives. There's not much that Secret can do.
And look, they just leave like, nothing.
Secret pretty much just watched their Barris
die.
Oh,
Jonas die. Want the
that
RP.
Was,
oh.
All right. All he right. didn't use it. It was all both pump fakes.
Yep. Just psyching him out.
That was pretty clutch. Both of those were pretty close
they
to going
They have vision
off.
Of him now, though.
Like,
Yep, there's the crush on Lift, and he's about to get healed up. He should live through this. Compliments of the Ghost. Now he pops the BKB. Perfect timing for him. And now MP kind of gets left behind. He uses the Eclipse. He's doing some good damage, but it will cost him his life. And he does not even find a single kill. Now Slardar comes in, does clean up the Skywrath. It's 800 gold unstoppable streak. Will they find more? It's a 4v4 left on the field, but of course, ultimate's on cooldown. Slardar, he's blinking all over the place. Where the fuck is he? There he is. He's down there. DP ties first. Now they'll turn it on to Ferev. Puppy eating somebody in the back line, but Ferev gets off another crush. They'll actually clean this up. Loda, he gets craggied. First hit by the Tiny, and then just turned around on. Now EGM making a little bit of space. The lone survivor, he does not have a TP. Pops the urn, and he might actually live. EGM, crazy bastard. Oh, I missed the recap. God damn it. Okay.
Who's casting? Zyorian, some no name.
Oh my god. Dude, that fight, I had trouble following the Slardar. At the end, I legit lost him. I apologize, guys. My eyes are.
I know, we're losing it.
I need to just lock it on the Slardar, man. He's blinking around. He's got a Force Staff and a Blink Dagger, plus he's Slytherin with his goddamn sprint. He's faster than hell. That was a surprisingly good fight for Secret, though. I mean, it just makes a little dent into the gold graph, and unfortunately, I mean, the real shame is that now that they took a good team fight, they've already had their base crippled, and the Octarine Core is up on DP. So this ult, 100-second cooldown, they can kind of just throw bodies at this bottom tier 3, and eventually that barracks is going to fall for Alliance. Their sieging at this point is so easy. Kind of rinse and repeat, pop BKB. Got this.
Some no name. Well, that bit finally got converted into a Rod of Atos here for EGM.
An Atos!
Yeah, nice little item. I thought maybe DP was going to get one while they were snowballing with the other one, but then she was able to just hold out long enough to get the Octarine.
Hello, Pylai die. Loda uses the BKB, goes in on the mid one, gets a little slow with the Echo Saber, and now Yonis with the RP. But there are a lot of friends here by, and they are clearly isolated. Loda in a lot of trouble. He's gotten eaten by Pudge. He gets the stun, he gets the turn! He buys a little more time for his team, and now the cavalry has arrived. Eclipse comes out. Yonis could still die. Konstian taking a lot of damage, but MP, Manta dodge. He could still stay alive. Will not. Now on the backside, Tiny's on the run. They hit him with the urn. Say goodnight to your Blink Dagger. He has the gem. They need this kill, and they might find it. EGM caught by the E-Blade there, but the soul sucky will come down. The gem hits the deck. And it's another okay fight for Alliance. 3-4, they find a small advantage. There is backdoor protection. They've got good creep equilibrium, so they can't charge up to the high ground with the ghosties, but they still find another successful engagement.
Yep, yep. This is the old school Tiny build, eh? Where you just go a full out nukes, next he just gets the Dagon.
Yeah, I guess so.
That's a Roche.
And Pi has recovered reasonably well, given how bad this game started for him. It was such a hard lane against the Death Prophet. Grossly outfarmed.
Yeah. The Tiny? Yeah.
Yep. Yep.
Mr. Mid one. Oh, there's BKB on a Luna. Nova.
Oh, there it is. Is this a new Luna set? I haven't seen this hairdo. Cutie hairdo.
Well, Andrew, I believe they're going to kill the beast known as Roshan and then walk up and destroy said buildings with a spin. What is your opinion on this? Do you think, quiet? Will the Dire contest and fight? It looks like they shall. A clash of the Titans, the Radiant have one with a bit of vision. Alright, so.
Tensions brewing around the Rosh Pit. Yes. Loda, ooh, he's got an Assault Kuros now, right? Even more attack speed. Yes. Forget about Roche, dude. They're going straight for the base.
Oh, lame. So rude, dude.
Harley. Come on, Loda.
Oh. Well, they...
Illusion.
Okay. Alright, they're
illusion.
Good.
All good. It's a little war cry. Where's the Pudge? Where's Biggie? There he is. He hooks Loader, but it's a BKB. They all disengage. That's a value hook.
I did also use Demonic Purge. Yep, right around the same time the BKB is. Hey, hey, hey!
I mean, are you gonna find a better time to try and force a fight, though?
No.
No BKB on Sven?
Put Shiva's Guard on Death Prophet. She also has the BKB.
Alright, any sentries down?
It does not look like it.
Nope.
Jonas is hanging on to the gem. He recovered it. They have no sentries. Pylai Dai actually does have a few sentries. They're in his inventory and he's in the way back. The deep south. Dire sentry comes down. Puppy. Ooh, it'll actually get this.
They haven't
ward.
Checked this yet. I guess there's no real easy way to do it.
Alliance hesitating here. They're going to go into the Roche pit. Secret starting to rotate over. Dire have a ward up on the high ground. Hook!
Oh.
Off the mark. Positioning there. The rest of Alliance smoked up. Ward just out of sentry range. Rev.
They have no slots.
Jumped on as he runs in. He dead. Now Rhodes about to fall. Rhodes with the BKB on. Aegis gets picked up by the DP. They have to pay with their Magnus, but now Loda with a nice stun on two. Brings down the other. MP pops his BKB, but guess what? Limp's doing physical damage, Big Daddy. Chasing her down. She might be riding him out, but Limp is just too goddamn fast. Nice hook from Puppy. That breaks the spirit siphon. A lot of Atos coming in handy. Drops the stun from the high ground. Well, it goes not too bad for Secret, but also not so great. Aegis still up on DP. Not one of the better Aegis carriers, of course, but still. Roche also was killed by the Alliance.
Yeah, they got it all, baby.
Yeah. Magnus did buy back there. So one buyback each. Slidar.
What is Magnus? They almost made a play there where, like, the Roche was dropping low, and then Pilot Eye disrupted the DP, and then they almost had a chance to steal it, because she didn't have, or rather, the Sven didn't have slots while he was killing it, but then they didn't kill the Roche in time, yeah. So nice attempt.
They're definitely up against the wall. It is the time where you got to make the crazy plays in some regard. A little surprised Alliance hasn't been able to close this out, though. Their 15k net worth lead is kind of stagnated now, plateaued. One lane of barracks away from Megas. Four Blink Naggers now up on the Dire. Two Force Staves. I wish we had a really good Southern caster. Like a legit
Southern. Like, one of those guys.
Yeah, somebody that was really good at Dota and had, like, not a hillbilly accent, but just like a little Georgia,
like
Savannah.
Like Matthew McConaughey when he puts his on. And you're like, oh, yeah.
Yeah. All right. EGM. He's going to get eaten by their pudge. EGM. Oh, nice hook there from Puppy. But, ooh, Yao Yule's the other way. RP on two. Skewer out of the Mystic Flare, but it's all right. Jonas gets the double.
He wants the kills. That's what it is.
Mm-hmm. So now on the other side of it, Limp is zoning him out. They're going to go into the lane. Who's there? It's... I know it's mid one. Oh, the Shiva's
got the dig on, dude.
Shiva's pretty tall, but couldn't quite reach that one. Now Loda jumps in, pops the BKB, just starts to focus on structures.
All right, mid one.
Defensive disruption.
Show me the
noob, some
dude.
Time.
Get
Limp
someone
now.
With this combo.
Ultimate on. They've got to do something. Buy back from Puppy.
Who's squishy enough? Look at that DP. It's only the Aegis.
She's got the Aegis.
Oh, there he goes!
Got okay. That's where she died? Up. Okay. That's sick laser.
I think... Oh, I don't know
they
forced
out the glyph. They almost kill the tower and another buyback. Like, again, Alliance just whittling their way further and further ahead. Slow and steady.
Boop, boop, boop. BKB, EGM. He is eclipsed.
Really?
He's done, dude. He's like, I'm sick of this shit.
He's like
a
proper core now. He is kind of moving into the position 3 now, outfarming Jonas. He's really close to the BKB, as you said. 3-3-12, a surprisingly good KDA. Loda, oh, the BKB. He's got those fast fingers.
Wow, the greed. Won't even give it to your DP.
Yeah.
She's got a doctorate, and he's like, nah, I just need it. I need it for my god strength, guys. I want a free kill.
He's his boss at the same time, the efficiency guys. I think Jim's fine. Mid lane. Silence.
He's pretty beefy now. He's got 2k HP. He's good. Maybe a little armor would help him out here. We've already got the Vlads and the AC, but hey, they've also got a Veil on Handskin. Something else we haven't really talked about, but a lot of magic damage to buff up here.
Secret are really worried about this time rating, it seems. I'm not sure how you bring this game back with single burst tiny.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, Secret losing this, I'm gonna have to tab out right fast. Double check, but I think Secret losing this game puts them
in
fear of tiebreak scenarios. Oh, great, so we're both tabbed out. So Secret, 5-1. Is that right? Yeah, okay. So VP and Ad Finum are the two teams that have made it through. Ad Finum won one of their other games. Hey, congratulations over there. But back to this game, Fareb jumps in, stunned up. He'll be okay for now, but the DPO's been deployed. There's no clip for the Dire, and this is their final hold. They're about to get Mega here. Eclipse comes out for the Luna. MP starting to do a lot of damage. Puppy gets a weird dismember, but it will just cost him his life. Now Silence, RP on the mid one. He was dead either way. It's just too much damage from Alliance. Buybacks now starting to come, but Megas have already been secured. Alliance can just get out now, cut their losses, and feel pretty safe that they've got this one in the bag. Jonas set up a pawn, and not enough follow-up. Another buyback here used by Secret. Luna has one, but we'll hold it for now. The game continues.
Dun-da-da-dun.
So, but your boys, the Greeks, dude, they're making it to the playoffs. They're good. They're in.
Oh, they're fully confirmed now?
They are done their games. They are 6-3, and they are in.
Wasn't that nice?
You know, I think the group stage is over. It doesn't matter who wins the next game, Secret and Liquid. I think they're the next two. Even if they lose out, it's 6 games, so they have 3 more to play. No, they're not guaranteed. They could still tie break with Vega and Imperial. So as long as Secret and Liquid don't lose all of their next games, then right, those are the top four.
Gotcha.
But if either of them lose two...
Do you know what the playoff format is? Do you choose your opponent?
It's just double limb. Oh, for opponent? It's probably top seed chooses opponent. That would be my guess.
Yeah.
But I don't know off the top of my head. I'd have to look it up. So, okay, this game actually really, really matters for Secret now. This could be the beginning of the spiral downward where they have to play tiebreakers.
And who would have thought it would come from a Meepo first ban?
Yeah, man. We have to wait and see the updated stuff after this heat. But it's getting to that point where there's a pretty definitive cutoff and there is just like an obscure tiebreaker scenario. Things go exactly according to plan. I don't think on paper is very likely. I think some of the matchups should be pretty one-sided, though this one probably should have been one-sided based on the standings, and it went the complete other way. So it goes to show you, no game is lost in the draft or before the draft.
Or the bans.
Or the bans or anything. No game is lost until your goddamn throne's down. Oh, Hooky on Loda again. This time he doesn't get off the TKB, but he's got teammates nearby. Lim pops the ghost. They've got the glyph, but their structure is going to start taking peripheral damage in this fight. Leaving on buybacks. Secret. Tight on options. ETM gets off the BKB. Nicely done. Loda jumps in. That's the end of Puppy. Now Fareb taking a lot of damage. He'll fall shortly as well. Lose Scepter. Maybe buys him some time, but down he goes. The Lucas' friends, GG's called, and Secret concede the game to Alliance after a dominant performance. I believe that is Alliance's last game of the tournament. Congratulations to them for, well, some good games, but brutal.
Winning on the way out.
Yeah, I mean, I guess it's good to end on a positive note, right? A little morale booster, but a heartbreaker to not...
True. Of course, you know, reformed and whatnot, but yeah. I think the DP was really solid. It's a good way to just, like, after you've read the full lanes of...
reserve time.
We are having a matchup between Team Secret and Na'Vi. And I'm sitting here together with Fog. We have the pleasure of commentating this match. Should be hype.
This one should be hype, but I feel like it might be a little anticlimactic, unfortunately.
You're thinking it's going to be one-sided in favor of Team Secret, correct?
Yes. They've been looking pretty hot lately. Na'Vi's been seeming like they have a few issues. I think the one game that we saw where they just kind of steamrolled Alliance was probably one of their better showings recently, yeah. But they do seem to be struggling a little bit.
That was also Alliance drafting very greedily. That was 2 days ago, yeah. Or something, so...
Very greedy Alliance draft, and Alliance didn't really play so hot.
Yeah. So Team Secret have... They're basically the only team, I think, that plays Bounty Hunter?
Yep.
So first ban Bounty Hunter normally would be uncommon to see that, but since it's Secret, that's understandable. We also have an IO Sanctuary and an OD ban. All those three are fairly normal. Oh, hello.
Woo! Na'Vi's been talking.
Na'Vi has a plan.
Yeah, they have a plan for sure. I like that they're going back toward the Earth Spirit. The hero's been kind of falling out of favor, but Tineko's pretty beastly on it. And the Batrider Earth Spirit's a combo that we used to see for a while. You know, the dual, they put like the dual kind of aggro thing. Or Tineko can just run around and make space anywhere. But General Batrider talked about it throughout, what, TI, Manila, everything. This guy is probably one of the best Batriders in the world. In the laning phase, he somehow always manages to get double kills and stuff. Like, he's extremely impressive on it. And his Sand King is actually really good too, but it seems like his Sand King was not doing so well lately, but either way, Secret banned it out, so.
Yeah. 10 seconds. General Bat, like, solid.
Yeah.
Very, very, very solid. Keeper of the Light is good against Earth Spirit.
Yes.
Did you just say that, or did I?
Oh, no, I didn't
okay,
say that.
Sorry.
I do like the Coddle versus Earth Spirit in general. I think Coddle's just a very... He can be very bad versus like every hero, but he can also be very good versus every hero if it's played in a proper manner. Which these guys probably play it one of the best. I mean, Puppy and Pie are pretty legendary Coddle players.
Yeah. Juggernaut picked up as well there, and I mean, both drafts fairly unusual with the Coddle and the Earth Spirit picked up, but the Juggernaut and the Batrider are comfort heroes for both teams.
Yeah.
And they don't reveal too much about what they're going to do. What do you know about the aggressive tri-lone situation for these two teams? Do they prefer it? Do they avoid it?
I think that these teams actually tend to avoid it. I think Secret does do the dual lanes, but that's... I feel like every time I've seen them do the dual lane, so whatever, it's with Puppy playing Bounty Hunter, and that's just kind of... It is what it is, you know, it's a Bounty Hunter. You're just being obnoxious. The quick ban coming out.
Yeah, compared to previous game, I mean, Na'Vi hasn't even dipped into their bonus time here at all.
Yeah, Timber, a very annoying hero. Pretty sure that, yeah, Secret played it a few times. Not too much, actually, but they didn't want to... I don't think Na'Vi wants to play versus it anyway. That hero can be annoying as hell, especially with Coddle getting the Chakram with the double Whirling Deaths. And 5 seconds. Just this massive damage potential.
Yeah, I like the Warlock ban as well. We saw yesterday how successful it was for Alliance. Sorry, was that yesterday? We saw how successful it was for Escape.
Escape
on
was 2 days ago.
Tuesday. Yeah, all games are blended into one, but a very successful hero, I think anyway. A hero that we're going to see a lot more of these qualifiers, and Shadow Demon removed as well. Annoying hero is all.
Yeah, just a strong, obnoxious hero, easy to rotate with. And wow, that's a very early spend pickup, but it's great versus Juggernaut in majority of favors. The Warcry is always good. Jug is pretty much pure physical besides Blade Fury.
Yeah, it's surprising to see Sven picked up so early. It really makes me think that Na'Vi has got like this specific plan that they're going for.
Yeah, it does. It really does seem like that. They've got a lot of lockdown already on their heroes. They're already bleeding a lot, but okay, Ogre picked up, though. That was one that we saw was banned first, too, in the last series, because Imperial plays it, like, every single game.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, this Ogre hero is falling into a very high fashion, apparently. been drafted like first two a lot of the time, but
yeah,
this is the first time I've seen it on Radiant in the last week, at least. From the game type.
Yeah, we've seen it be very successful on the Dire side so far.
Yeah.
Overall, though, with the Juggernaut, it pairs up nicely. It's still very strong with Lane Harass, and Bloodlust is strong as ever.
Maybe Na'Vi banned the Timbersaw and the Life Stealer because they can do pretty well versus Batrider in like a 1v1, and they want to give General a like the best advantage you possibly can. Life Stealer is pretty annoying. Batrider is pretty hard to play versus Life if you just rage off and run at you pretty early in the laning phase.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is the first of the Na'Vi sticking into their bonus time, so perhaps...
Invoker! Yeah, they're completely switching things up from what we've been seeing, at least recently. They haven't actually played too much, actually. I was taking a look. I thought they'd played more. They've only played, like, 10 matches total in the past month, and they have picked 0 Invoker during that time. Only 1 Sven, which they won with. And a couple Batrider units, but...
Yeah, general Batrider. I think Batrider's also, or rather offlaners, there's a little bit of a smaller pool that you pick from lately.
Yeah, but it looks like Na'Vi definitely, I think after the games yesterday and stuff, the other day, they had a talk and they were like, okay guys, like let's just go toward our comfort instead of like all these meta heroes, I guess quote-unquote meta heroes. This patch is a patch where you can pick pretty much anything as long as you play in the proper manner.
Then let's be real, Dendi is never gonna perform bad on an Invoker.
No,
right?
Definitely not. And they have a lot of setup now for it too. It's Cold Snap with Earth Spirit rolling in is very nice in the laning phase too. It gives your Invoker a little bit of leeway. And yeah, like the Sven stun, Lasso, Earth Spirit stun, all decent setups for Sunstrike. And it permeates through Blade Fury, which can always be nice versus Juggernaut.
Okay, so talk to me about Tidehunter.
I think Secret's one of the few teams that still really like Tidehunter. It's been seeing a little bit more Tidehunter stuff, but
Forev plays it, right?
Yeah, Forev plays it, and Forev's an animal, actually. Watching his stream, that guy's so freaking good. If you want to learn Dota, if you want to learn stuff about high tier Dota, watch Forev for sure. But Tidehunter, it's gonna be really hard for Na'Vi to actually kill that with a Sven Earth Spirit. They haven't shown their third support, but Tidehunter should be able to contest pretty well, especially if there's an Ogre. So maybe this is where we're gonna see Secret go for some type of dual lanes and just moving around to cause a little bit of a ruckus on Na'Vi's short lane.
Just looking for the mid one hero. It's a Templar Assassin that gets removed. Mid one used to be famed for his Invoker, so that one's no longer an option here. What do you like to play up against an Invoker in mid?
I feel like I keep seeing mid one playing like the Storm, the Embers and stuff. Probably not the best this game versus Earth Spirit, Sven, Invoker, Batrider because of how much disabled there is.
Yeah.
What else does mid one really like? He actually has a massive hero pool, so it's pretty hard to determine.
Okay,
so they do go for the Storm anyway.
Yeah.
I just feel like they love this because it's... I don't know, just maybe one of the strongest heroes. It benefits from Bloodlust. It's just likes it a lot. Why not? If he's super confident.
If it works for them, and I think if he gets the right backup in terms of supports, he should be okay.
Interesting. Rasta ban from Secret, too. So they're like, all right, Na'Vi needs something else to maybe accelerate their Roshan and tower push besides just ban and the Invoker. So the Rasta ban. I know Artstyle used to play it a bit. One of the few that picked it up still.
Well, one more hero to go. Bonus time used.
Versus Storm and Jug.
They love their jungle heroes and their rotating heroes, but Earth Spirit is already a hero that can very well rotate mid and help out Dendi in that mid lane.
Artstyle loves his Chens, his Enchantress. Yeah. Those are his big two most favorable, I'd say, but... since they do have the Earth Spirit, maybe he'll go for something different. But every time I've said that, actually, they picked one of the two heroes I've said. So I'm just going to stick with the Chandra Enchantress.
Well, maybe there's going to be a bigger curveball, Enigma.
Oh, I haven't seen that hero in ages.
No, exactly.
That's one of the few.
I mean, it's also a jungle hero, but it's not as aggressive in the early game. And Arcel really likes to be aggressive in the early game, so... It really depends on how active they're planning, like you said, how active they're planning to be with that Earth Spirit. And how much control they want to have give Sven over the lane. And, of course, if they're expecting a duel lane from the Tidehunter.
Ooh.
Or if they're they're expecting just a solo Tidehunter or not, and it will be a silencer there, so...
It's great synergy with the Batrider, something that... It's like a pick that... A combo that we've seen many times from lots of teams, but didn't really expect that one to come out of Na'Vi. But Na'Vi is complete... They completely changed up their plan from what we've seen in the last, like, couple weeks at least. They're going back to their comfort, and I feel like this should look pretty good for Na'Vi. I think the draft is fairly even, but I like that Na'Vi's going back to what, you know, what they like, but they do have a pretty hard game set for them. They do have, it's a Sven and Invoker as their two core heroes versus the Storm Jug. Just that matchup in general is a little bit tough because the, you know, the Storm and the Jug are going to be benefiting from Bloodlust the entire time.
Last player to be killed before the GG is called.
What? Wait, is that before the GG is called? Oh, just the last person to die, right?
Last person to die.
Wait.
Pilot die? Why not?
I have no idea.
Will a tower be killed before 10 minutes? Not with this lineup.
I don't think either team should get a tower kill. Maybe Secret if the offlane gets, like, crushed.
Hold that thought!
Uh-oh.
Jira. There's a Gush available. There's not enough range.
He skilled the Gush right away, too. So what? This is an aggro.
Yeah.
More than likely. He even has boots.
Total number of Roshan kills.
That one could be a couple.
Three? Two.
Two's pricey. 0-2 seems like such a safe one.
Total number of smoke gank kills at game end.
What kind of questions are these? 13? The game has to go forever for 13.
Well, it depends on if you get 5 kills off of 1 smoke gank.
True. True. I don't know.
We're gonna gamble. Oh, you Shiver. We're gonna be,
why not?
Why not?
So, really quick, looking at the warding actually situation, since because we didn't really talk about that at all the last game. Level 1 TP by Earth Spirit puts one down there. Batrider, I think, TP'd as well. Blocked the hard camp with the Sentry and put a Vision Ward. And then the Radiant. Secret side puts one to block the pull camp. So they're doing like a pseudo dual lane, like we were mentioning, and Puppies just kind of run around wherever.
We have Forev on his Tidehunter, supported by Pilot Dynasty. Keep of the Light with Arcbound the Jirah there, and actually they're gonna go
right away.
Sunstrike dead. Already, won't it? That for
you put Puppy for your prediction.
No,
you didn't. You put Pi, didn't you?
Yeah, but it was Pi that died. They just
well, I guess
they're just
okay.
Bad because it's just wrong.
Yep. Well, so much for that one, Shiva. Good job.
But no, but that's not that achievement. It's gonna get updated every time one person dies. And this is wrong too because it wasn't Puppy that died.
Last one to be killed, because he hasn't died, so he... whatever.
Last player to be killed. And it was Pilot Eye that died. I don't know
how this works. Thanks, Val. Whatever. Yeah, no idea. Great. But Na'Vi, no hesitation, though. That was sick. Like, instantly, they just went on him.
Yeah, talking about people going on people, General has to run away here from MP. Well, how do you feel about the Juggernaut matchup against the Batrider?
You can spin off the... Sticky, sure, but I think Batrider overall can win this matchup just because you're able to spam him down. You can't spin off every single one of the sticky stacks. You should be able to farm pretty well, but I think it'll be fairly even still. I think maybe it's a little bit bat favored until Jug gets some levels.
Okay. Not for a while. Well, I gotta say, Puppy's been setting mid for a while, but he's going, he's going back mid. Gets his Bloodlust to mid one.
Yep, that was the one thing I was going to be a little worried about, is if where Sendeko is going to run around, but he should definitely just sit around mid lane because, yeah, the Ogre is going to be staying there too, so it's going to be a semi-duo lane mid.
Yeah, and the supports will be the ones keeping control over those runes.
Mid one with 10-3 CS to the Dendi, only 4-0 right now, so the Bloodlust is really helping mid one right now.
Nine! He had 9! Of the Sticky Napalm stack. That's crazy.
Yeah.
And, luckily he has a magic stick, so he can use it to get a spin-off still, but... Wow, that is some scary stuff right now, and we do have Puppy rotating bottom, so...
General
the dual lane mid
out.
Is not there anymore for mid one. Oh, hello.
Uh-oh.
This seems like a very difficult lane for Secret here on the top.
Like,
looking for the stun, he has got the stun, gets a double stun with that as well.
Oh, they might actually get Forev here as well.
Yeah, why not? Anchor Smash still comes out, but it doesn't matter.
He doesn't have his... How am I just burping right now? He doesn't have his W with
Kraken Kill. Yeah, he doesn't have Kraken Kill, he doesn't have a Stout Shield, anything, so he actually takes a lot of damage from right clicks. Yeah, brain lag right there for a moment.
That's okay. It is still early. Fairly early.
Fairly early.
Oh, shit!
Oh, no! The overlay! Oh, God.
Overlay, sorry. Well, we're casting mostly for in-game viewers.
Oops. 732 people are going to be pretty upset for 3 minutes.
Yeah. For 3 minutes. My bad. Do you see how I say my bad while actually 30 pixels saying it?
Yeah.
It's good.
Whoops. It's the morning.
It's
the morning.
It's so early.
So MP is doing fairly well. General as well. He moved back down as soon as Puppy moved. He touched. Pressuring, typical general things, but mid one, look at this mid lane, 24-3 to the 10-5 again.
How is this possible?
Bloodlust. He gets like an extra auto attack every single time, so he's able to last hit easier. The rage is coming. They're trapped in a cage.
But it's only 3 minutes, guys, and I'm very happy that downstairs are actually commentating off of Dota TV, so they don't see it at all. Although we just said it out loud. Yo, well, I'm not gonna type, but it will be 65.
Oh, Pi again.
Nice stun again. Pi is having a very, very bad time. 0-3-0.
That's a lot of int. I think Silencer's got an int every single time.
Yeah.
So that Coddle is probably sitting.
I think that's one of the sad things that we can't see how much intellect he actually lost.
He's lost. He's 3 deaths, so all 3 of those he's definitely lost.
Yes, but there's like no thing saying that. So he has lost 6 intellect.
Minus 6.
Sad life.
Oh, well.
There's nothing to be doing. Nothing to be done about it now. Oh. It's unfortunate. It really is. But on the bright side, now we've had it. It's not going to happen again.
Yep. So. Just remember, guys, there is a 5-minute delay for these games, so typing T-Taurus about the overlay, we noticed it a couple minutes ago, it's happening. Whatever.
We even noticed it before the T-Taurus went off.
And we did.
I think that's pretty admirable.
We noticed it only 3 minutes late, not 5.
Yeah. Woo. Big decay. Okay. So, Pilot Die, I think, has made the smart decision. Like, okay, Forev. There's experience coming into the tower. You take all of that as Juggernaut dies on mid, but we're not following Juggernaut, we're following mid one who is not dying to creep. Never
mind. Wait, what?
Juggernaut died. Sunstrike. Invoker got the kill.
I guess he was holding the stick, his stick, trying to like big play general and just get Sunstrike. Alright.
Yep.
That's
what you get.
Pretty
being cocky.
Huge, actually.
Ow. I hear myself. That's awkward. That's very loud all of a sudden.
Yeah.
I wonder if we can turn that up later on. Okay, so... So who's winning this laning stage?
Definitely Navi.
Definitely Navi.
Yeah. Mid one's doing very well, and I think he actually has stacks. I think Puppy was stacking in the jungle for the Storm Spirit, it looks like.
So you're saying that Navi's winning despite mid one doing amazingly well?
Yes, definitely. They have 5 kills, I mean.
Well, it is not all about the kills. I mean, even if you look at the net worth, there's a storm that's like on top. I do see the other 3 cores being
all Navi. Experience is pretty large, and having your silencer get that much free int this early is pretty sweet.
And even if it is a support silencer.
And Artstyle is one of those players, though, that always ends up having, like, when his enchant and stuff, it's like, oh, Dragon Lass Aghanims, you know, etc., etc. So.
Yeah. Don't worry, we fixed it.
Now we get yelled at by Owen.
Yeah.
Gods.
No, no, no. It was Owen's fault to begin with, remember?
It was Owen's fault to begin with, yeah.
Easy. It's soon.
So?
I will just say soon. Soon. Okay. General is doing fairly well in this offlane. We'll go for the bat. The Blink Dagger.
Yeah, he's doing great.
He has the gold for it.
This is like more than what you'd want. That Sunstrike kill actually put him in a very good position. Yeah.
So,
he's pressuring MP so hard, sticky.
So in terms of making rotations, so far we've seen only the supports rotate in and out. At what point are we going to see a difference in that?
I think that we should be seeing on the screen right now.
Oh.
As you say it, make the first move.
Yeah, mid one makes the first move. Let's see if it's a successful one. It definitely is, and he gives a kill to MP as well. With the one hit omni slash.
Yeah. I mean, that was kind of a spite right there. He's like, killed me, I kill you.
Yeah, don't worry. The overlay is about to disappear. It's all good. It's all good. Okay. So, the mid one rotates first. Denny as an invoker is not going to rotate anytime soon.
Yeah, they're just putting him in jungle and giving Sinead low levels in mid lane.
And he does need to rotate. He has Sunstrike to help out. So that is enough on that one. And Ferev, well, Ferev is a little bit sad. He does have a Ravage. Doesn't carry a TP scroll. Which is something that if this was a pub, he would probably get flamed for it.
Yeah, I'm really liking the way Navi's looking right now, though. The Sven is pretty much in, like, even ties with the Storm Spirit, and the Invoker is a bit ahead of the Juggernaut, even though they weren't laning in that manner, but still.
Yeah, well, mid one rotating bottom again, and he has got a spin available if they just have anything to stop him. But they didn't skill Vortex, they didn't skill the Fire Blast.
Ooh,
no disables! Oh, Courier. Uh-oh, I don't think that Snake who can... Maybe he can.
Warding mission.
Oh, he's going in. He's going for Puppy. Has got some backup there as well, Sunstrike. Will hit. Couple of hits needed. The Silence is there as well. And he comes Batrider and Dendi just in case they're needed. But Sonako will be getting the last punch in first. This thing is so wrong.
It's because they haven't... It's the last person to die after... Like, the last person to have a death, I think. I think that's how it works. So it's updating saying that guy hasn't died yet. Because everybody else has died. So now it's if mid one dies, it's gonna say somebody else's name.
Oh well, then we completely misunderstood.
I don't know. Oh, there's a global coming out.
I think that's for top lane, saving for Ev. That's what they want to do. Maybe get a kill on the turn as well. But did Jiraiya get the stun in before mid one can get the zip off of all style? Oh, comes the Ravage. Very nicely done. Ev has to be careful though. He's very low. But did Jiraiya? He gets Vortex. There it is. That level one Vortex value there. Lasso, Blinding Light helping out. Did Jiraiya not able to hit mid one anymore? If he were to go for that one, General flying out, he has still got his Firefly, but Omni Slash from MP, who has to run back through fire. Oh, Healing Ward has to run back through fire. He's fine.
Such
Zeus.
Zeus.
Why is Zeus not picked anymore lately? Like, never. Almost.
Too many nerfs. Static Field nerf, too many bugs.
But he's still fairly successful in pub.
Yeah. I don't know. He just doesn't really do much. He just kind of stands there mid and farms, right? Invoker can Sunstrike all the... That's from level 1. And he actually scales very, very hard. He's at least has the physical aspect of straight magic. And it's a core. Like, that Zeus core, which is just no physical whatsoever. It's painful.
It's pretty sad, actually. Fair enough. But in those situations, wouldn't you love to have the Zeus or Injured Apparition? Yeah. I guess Denny with the Sunstrike could have tried, but he already had it used, so...
Yeah, he was just off the mark of getting one of them, but mid one, with his nice rotation so far, has actually made a lot of work, but unfortunately, he actually hasn't picked up a single kill from them, which definitely think that they should have tried to give him one of those last hits, but...
I'm not too sad with MP getting two of them, though. He needed them too. He was not doing all too well. Now he's second on last hits.
Yeah.
Second on net worth, rather. So it looks like we have got a bit of a gathering coming up here from Navi, perhaps. Nobody on top lane anymore. Did you right claiming the ancients?
Yeah, and it looks like so we had a tower not before 10 minutes. There was the tower at 12 minute mark, first one that goes down. And General actually opted to go for a stat build rather than go for that blink build on the Batrider. At least for now, he probably bought them as he was dying.
Yeah. I mean, he's still fairly far off, and I think he finds that, you know, there's no rush. There's still not a team that wants to initiate. Even if he would have a Blink Dagger, he would still not be able to do more than what the Nurse Spirit already can by himself in terms of initiation, if they want to go for the initiation. So far, he's been getting those lassos off quite decently.
Yeah, he definitely wants it, though, because they have the combo.
Yeah,
with
with
the Soundster and everything with the Spen. Yeah, he definitely will, I mean, get it eventually. But maybe he'll go for the drum if he's dying again. He doesn't want to keep getting delayed on his items, but...
Well, for his sake, I hope he doesn't have to.
Yeah. I think they probably need that flank build to go for a tower push.
to get that pick off into pressure, but Perev recovered very well after that kind of disaster start in the top lane. He actually has his mech finished up.
Yeah.
And now they're just farming the ancients, stacked up by Pi and Puppy, and Pi's able to just always chakra the Tidehunter and the Storm throughout the situation. A very strange death. That.
I mean, we saw him sitting in the jungle. And apparently he was just waiting for the moment someone to show up by himself. No creeps around, Omni slashed, and he dies.
Yeah, that's, I don't think Sinico really expected him to be there at all.
Nope. I don't think anybody was expecting him to be there. Is it worth missing out on quite a bit of farm just sitting in a jungle waiting for a kill?
Why not, right?
Why not?
He is one of those players that likes to go for kills over the farm, right? He's very aggressive. And yeah, I mean, why not, right? Getting a kill with your army slash is always efficient.
Oh, there's a Ravage up. They find General. In comes the Ignite. The Gush there as well, but they...
That's too deep.
Yeah, they know. Too many people that can come in with the Tier 1 tower still up.
Quick to turn, though. I like that. That's secret. Like, right away, they identified. Right after the Gush. That's not good.
And in terms of... In comparison to what we saw with other teams, like, they're on the same page.
Yeah, definitely.
They get the call, like, okay, we're back. And nobody hesitates. Everybody just... goes back, knows what to do, or knows what not to do, rather.
Yep, that's two towers now for Secret. They have, like, this mech thing is like the last game as well. Group up on the mech timing and go. And Na'Vi doesn't have a mech carrier for quite a long time. No one who's a natural mech carrier, at least. You can maybe get one on, like, the Silencer or the Earth Spirit, but that's not, like, a Tidehunter or a Dark Tier.
There's a carrier, actually. Oh, didn't bring his item. Well, it's a shame.
Yeah. Na'Vi can't really fight into this though. They're afraid of the Ravage mech. They're just going for the split pressure.
Where they get a tower? Oh, I was gonna say they're gonna get a tower in return, but Secret doesn't want to have any of that. They'll defend that tier 1 bottom just fine. This is the right thing to do if you're Na'Vi though. We saw in the previous game what it could bring if you do try to fight into that.
Yeah,
how it can just ruin your game.
Very scary though, after General was having a pretty decent laning phase, now he's just having nothing, and Ditch of Rock caught in with nothing.
Yeah, I mean, he gets a stun off, but I don't think that matters at all. It's a mid one. Global Silence coming out. That's from Na'Vi, and I feel like that was miscommunication 101. If it was there earlier, I think Ditch of Rock could have maybe lived. Or at least could have bought more time for the team to come in, but with the Global Silence coming out at that time.
I don't know, that's...
That's a question mark.
Dichira was super far up by himself with nobody even close to him. Yeah, I don't know.
There's no vision there either. Let's see if they can catch Poppy though. General really wants it. He gets Omni Slash the moment that he shows though, and it's enough for the kill because it is level 2 Omni Slash.
And the Sun Strike's off the mark, and 4F claims a tower by himself here. Oh man, all sorts of disaster for Na'Vi.
I mean, after the draft, we said Na'Vi's lineup, you know, looked pretty solid. But just the team play coming together for Team Secret is... It's just showing, for now, the better team, the better plan, rather. They have a plan, they stick to it, they know what to do.
Yeah, Puppy's just a walking bloodlust, pretty much. Honestly.
Yeah.
He really is. He
doesn't even expect his last stun, it's just max bloodlust. Bloodlust everybody that he sees. And it's working out.
Yeah, working great.
That's why your first pick, Ogre.
Probably have like what a 5 or 6k, maybe a little bit higher net worth lead right now.
Oh, a sentry ward.
But yeah, Na'Vi's. It's 16 minutes in, and I feel like they're almost trapped in their base at this point.
Yeah, look at that gold graph. A little bit of a problem there. I'm waiting for mid 1 to decide he's waited long enough and zips in on someone, but we'll see if that happens.
Yeah, they're just gonna group up and go for another tower now too. They're like, alright, Na'Vi's on their side of the map pretty much completely except for General, so we'll just take the enemy jungle, farm it all out, take towers. Na'Vi need to... I don't know, they need to try to get some pickoffs and stuff, but Secret's not really giving them the opportunity. They're sticking together. And now they have the blink on Tidehunter too.
In the meantime, General, finally. Ta-da!
Yay!
17 minutes into the game, after having a laning stage that wasn't actually too bad. They even got a kill on MP.
Yeah.
Fairly late one there.
Couple deaths just really set him back hardcore, and they haven't been able to really pressure towers too well with their lineup. They got the one bottom tower. Now they, I think this is a desperation.
That's a deny, even. That tier one bottom. So they lose a tier two top on Na'Vi. I do believe that Na'Vi should be aware that something like this is going on. They had the ward over there. They saw them pass over here earlier.
Oh, they're actually going to get it for free. Uncontested completely. That's great. I mean, it's not...
That's a win.
It's not what's going to win them the game, but it's you know, small steps, baby steps.
It will give them a better chance of a high ground defense when it comes, because I don't believe that is too far off. Maybe after this tier 2 tower. Still last one standing on the side of Na'Vi.
We'll probably see Secret just wait the Aegis out, honestly. They can just farm and not really be too worried. Look, even Pi's prepping for this game to go into a later fashion, prepping for that Aghanim's, which is ridiculous on Coddle.
Yeah, that's crazy, actually. And since Puppy's only a walking bloodlust, he doesn't need items, so he can just spend his money on wards and stuff.
Yep, he's like, alright, I got my raindrop, that's all the mana regen I need.
I say that, but Pi still buys the wards as well.
Yeah.
Because Puppy earlier had like 1,000 gold. Oh,
yeah, there
we
go.
He bought
a full hood. Okay, so he's gonna go for the pipe.
Yeah. Oh, it's useful. They can deal better with the Earth Spirit. Oh, hello, mid one. The silence stopped and a little bit of trouble, and he has to deny himself. Yeah, last player to be killed. Well, that's a very. It was Dendi. That's a very difficult description, I think.
I kind of understood it, but
Dendi last one to be killed, but there's no detection, and he would actually be killed if they just had detection. Even the Illuminate almost was enough to kill him, man.
Nope. Yeah, he went for the Yule's build too. So a bit of a change up. We haven't seen that too much lately, actually. He's just like what the Drum Magnum Box might it's.
Well, teams like Team Secret has full map control.
Yep. That's great item build from MP. I love the defusal versus the silencer and everything.
Yeah.
And versus their spirit. You remove the global from yourself and even your teammates if you need to.
Long zip in from mid one after he died earlier on. Want to go for the Jira. The target to get the Sven, the core, the carry of Na'Vi drops down. Has an Aegis. Where is his team? Needs some backup. There's a Ravage available as well. People come and help him out. He doesn't get Omni slashed and slowed down, and there is nothing.
Yeah, I'd say that they maybe didn't want to fight into the Aegis, but they have no concerns of what Na'Vi does. They actually don't care.
And Na'Vi didn't seem to have any answer for that either. There's just Arxel standing on the high ground. We'll get picked up as well, and they'll just move forward to get the tower as well. In the meantime, Dendi, all he can do is, he didn't go back to base after almost dying in mid lane. He went to bottom lane. He's now too low to fight, would have to get back to his fountain first before doing anything at all. And General also is like, okay, you know, I abandoned my base. I'll just try to farm something.
This doesn't... They had great... Like the first few minutes, Na'Vi looked like they were coordinating very well, but now it's like everyone's just doing their own thing. It looks like there's complete disconnection.
Should they be doing anything? Like,
I mean, they can't just lose the game. They're losing Braxis right now. They're sitting at tier 2 trying to set up for a kill.
Is this what?
But now they can't even.
Okay, fight. Now they're teleporting. They were hoping that someone would teleport to defend, but really, are you going to defend at tier 2 when you have a chance of getting a melee Rax? Or two sets of Rax even on this top lane? Oh, there's a global silence. The lasso as well on the Juggernaut. And in comes the Ravage in just a second. It is a full 5-man Ravage. Very nicely done by Ferenc there as Sven is in too deep. Ends up dropping. The rest of Na'Vi is already getting back to the fountain while the Rax are falling down. GG's gold. That is it. 22 minutes. Well, this is turning into a pretty fast series of games here. I think we might need to wait a little bit for the next one even.
Sineko left without even saying anything either. It seems like there might have been...
Ouch.
Something not going too well with Na'Vi there that game.
This was their first series as well for the qualifiers. Of course, you are watching the European regional qualifiers for the Boston Major. It is 10 teams, round robin. Everybody faced each other once. And a good start for Team Secret, 22-minute victory.
Radiant Team, Baron.
Alchemagi!
As a good team, you've had a bad start. So you come into your first match. You're not versing another team who's fresh. You're versing a team who's had a bit of a rough day. You got to see their game, see what they've been picking,
yep.
Had time to prepare, and we'll see how much that helps Liquid, because Liquid has been pretty crummy lately. They've not had a good couple of weeks.
I think that a lot of their fans are slightly disgruntled by their recent results. And I think that the qualifiers, this is the time where we're going to see if some of their losses might just be them trying out new things, or if it really wasn't going well with the entire team. So it will be an interesting game for sure, and definitely one that can set the tone for Liquid doing well in this qualifiers, because they still have the potential. And Imperials going back to their roots, opening with the Centaur.
Dang, that's bold. It's only like,
very bold.
I mean, it's just a first pick Ogre. Like, Ogre reveals nothing, and they're like, here, let's reveal everything. Entire strat. Centauroid. I mean, by entire strat, I just mean like their carry and their mid, but that's still a lot of information to give away this early on.
Yeah, you were saying earlier that if you're going for a Centaur then in the safe lane, which is what Imperial's probably going to do, they have been playing Ace as a Centaur safe lane, you want to have a mid that can transition into being a core. Physical damage dealer, and I'm not sure if OD is that hero.
He's close. He's not way better than Warlock, which was the hero they had last time. He's at least a carry style mid hero.
Yeah.
Doesn't do physical damage, but can do a lot of burst damage, does right click pretty hard. And Liquid immediately pick up lifesteal in the first phase. This is a key hero against the Centaur, because the way it's played in Ace's hands is he gets huge amounts of HP. He gets up to like 4k HP when he hits the Vanguard plus heart timing. And that's where lifesteal, his feast, is just amazing because it's percent based damage. And lifesteal against a Centaur. So lifesteal is like a direct counter to the carry Centaur in that way.
I mean, that's gonna throw Imperial off a bit. Surely.
Yeah, it's also something that, like, in some ways you almost have to think you gotta expect it if you're staging a Centaur. It's also Matu's like top two, top three heroes. So.
And it's regardless, in this entire meta, the lifestealer has been having a high priority for a lot of teams.
Mm-hmm. I wonder if Imperial could even throw a curveball and run like an offlane center, if that's something they would ever consider. Maybe they intentionally first stage pick the Centaur to try and mislead Liquid, when it's really going to just be like an offlaner.
Possible.
And then they draft around it being a safe lane Centaur, and then fifth pick comes out, boom! Instead of an offlaner, they pick a carry. That could be the play.
So we still have Sand King in the pool.
Yes, thank you. Yes. That's love. It's kind of weird. There's still like, I mean, you pick OD Central Force 2. There's so many heroes that got ignored. Shadow Demon got ignored. Tank King got ignored.
Yeah. Io.
Drow. Oh, no, Drow got banned. Never mind. So Drow's me. Yeah, Io got ignored. Imperial just picked so peculiarly that often heroes they think that shouldn't be ignored get ignored.
Well, we'll see if maybe they still pop up so far. I mean, the Oracle removed from the pool. I don't blame him for that one. It's just an annoying hero to deal with if you're going on someone. You don't want that saved. And especially if you have a lifestealer that has like this key moment when he is in rage. That's the time where you want to do most of your damage. That's the time where you want to fight. Oracle can just use one spell, and during your entire rage, you're not really doing that much. So, good ban. And Razor. I mean, they just want to ban out heroes that are good against OD mid.
Yep.
Invoker, Razor. Fair enough. Radiant team. Really? So Team Liquid, one of the problems that we've seen from them is that they are going for... First of all, they're going for some unconventional heroes they're giving them to Miracle.
That's right.
And also, Mind Control has been struggling on that offlane a bit. And whether that was due to laning or due to... I mean, people have been saying communication issues or tilting. He is a very emotional player. We don't really know, but we'll see. Well, that's going to get some extra attention in this game, at least. And it looks like Liquid is expecting this also to be a center core, indeed. The ban is still out, ban out the Sand King.
for now. I think it's obviously what your first thought should be is that prepare for a carry tanking, but by the time you get to that fifth pick, if Imperial pick up two supports now, Liquid have to at least consider the possibility of an offlane Centaur. But still, Lifesteal is a good pick even against the offlane Centaur. He's got a very long cast time on the Hoofstomp, so you can almost always rage dodge that if you're good at Dota, which Matthew, I hear, is pretty good at Dota. So Imperial, whether it's a core or an offlane, either way, the Lifesteal is a hero they're going to have to worry about. But see what the plan's going to be for now. At this point, you're guess just trying to secure some of your standard supports. They get the Dazzle for now.
Ryze has played a lot of Dazzle. It's a solid support. Really nothing much to say about the Dazzle. Ignite's going to be tricky to deal with, as it has a pretty long duration. Longer than the Grave one, I think.
10 seconds yep. remaining.
So we need to have that heal, not just the Grave.
5 seconds remaining.
For Team Liquid, I mean, you already said it. Picking up an Oracle life, or sorry, an Ogre Lifesteal doesn't really give anything away at all. So
no,
they can use Oracle, or sorry, Ogre again for just harassing mid, harassing bottom, harassing top. They can do whatever they want.
Maybe want to pick up a mid here that benefits from the Bloodlust is one of the main considerations. But again, you can don't even have to play a Bloodlust style of Ogre. You can go for the max Ignite, 1 point in Bloodlust, and just have a more, I guess, tempo controlling mid like your Puck. Your Rubik, this miracle after all, who knows what it can bust out.
Disruptor.
But for now, the pickup of support, the good laning one.
Not a team that we normally see pick up Disruptor. We've seen a lot of Disruptors in the CAS scene and on Alliance, but that's about it. Disruptor. I like it.
And the silence is decent against COD. Wondering if they're going to go into a Slaughter Lifestealer duo, because Disruptor is very good with Slaughter, so and this makes me think their fourth pick is going to be Slaughter for Mind Control. It's also one of his better heroes. Because Disruptor, like with Lifestealer, I mean, again, it's a decent support, there's good laning presence. Doesn't heavily counter any of Imperial's heroes by any means. Punch!
Yeah.
Here we go.
I think
Noia normally
seen
plays
it.
Yeah, at least one game of them.
Yeah.
Either in Kiev at WESG or...
I think it was this week still.
Was it Dreamleaf? There was a lot of Pudge from Alliance at Dreamleaf.
Yeah.
So two games of them playing the Pudge.
And the Pudge has to have a big impact as well. I mean, that's... If you don't have a big impact as a Pudge, you're kind of... Like, you pick him up because of the hook. Right?
Yep.
That's the main reason there.
It's definitely... Yeah, that's your
it's very good against a Lifestealer.
True.
Your rage doesn't mean anything anymore. You can dismember through it. You can hook through it. Let's see the answer of Team Liquid.
If someone gets hooked, you can still instantly break the dismember as a disruptor, though, because your glimpse is such a low cast rate. So it's hard to follow up hooks with dismembers, but I guess the hero is still out of position. So even canceling a dismember doesn't save their life. So, fourth pick for Liquid. Is it going to still be the Slaughter? I could lean that way, but maybe there's something else.
It's good against Pudge as well. If you get hooked, you can just get a crush and you're home free. Just sprint away.
Nope. Slaughter. Nothing
good call.
Big surprise. Disruptor is kind of like the giveaway there, I guess, for the most part.
So, for last picks, we are missing a Miracle Hero.
Yep.
And we are missing a, well,
Centaur.
Either Hester Joe or Ace Hero.
Most likely Hester Joe, but
yeah.
Again, I feel like the one time I saw the Centaur pick fail the hardest when Imperial played it was against Alliance. And it was, I think it was a Slaughter Jug that game where they had amp damage Omni Slash and Centaur got owned by the physical damage. Slaughter Lifestealer wrecks Centaur. So if anything, you want to play like a utility offlane Centaur with like Blink 4 stuff. Go for the utility items rather than the Heart of Tarrasque and those big items. I would feel a lot more confident about Imperial's draft with an offlane Centaur right now. I think the carry Centaur just does not work.
If you would go for an offlane Centaur, which core would you like to see with it?
So what are they looking for? Laning-wise, they're lane strong regardless. They've got the Dazzle there.
Yeah.
You're versing... It depends on the mid of Liquid, really. Like, right now, all you know is they've got the Lifestealer core as kind of low armor hero. You want something that can either be ranged and take advantage of the Lifesteal that way, like a Terra Blade style hero, or you want to go for maybe like a jug to be okay, because you just Omni Slash and deal with lifesteal pretty well that way. But it is Ace. He plays some unconventional heroes himself. Not too sure what better time.
Brood still in the pool.
Ace actually also plays the Brood. It's weird because they're one team who plays the Brood on their mid player and their carry player, but not. I don't think I've seen Hestiger play it.
Me neither, actually, as the offline player.
Yeah. I want to lick. What miracle hit off?
You need to move the microphone a little bit close, otherwise, you cut off. Templar Assassin. And there's Templar Assassin.
Whoa, a lot of physical damage.
Loads of physical damage.
Armor Heroes. High Armor Heroes is what you're thinking. Morphling could come into concern. Morphling and Terrorblade are the two that stand out to me. Heroes with lots of armor that don't just get blown up instantly by the initiation. It's surely not a game for a carry center. I think that's just like a losing recipe.
They can't. Sven? They pick up
Sven could be really good, perhaps. Sven Dazzle, Warcry.
Yeah.
Please just don't run a carry centaur Imperial. Do it for my sake, for my sanity. I don't want to see a carry centaur here. The carry centaur, but just not this game. Everything about this draft is to counter the carry centaur. You've just outdrafted them. Pick a different carry. Oh, they're gonna do the carry centaur.
Okay,
I thought they were on some next level things, but maybe not. What was that, sir?
What's the peak time of Team Liquid? Are they a mid game team?
They're not an early game team. I mean, mid game, yeah, with Blink Dagger Slaughter is really their timing. You get the Blink on Slaughter, you've got the Infest Bombs, you find kills around the map. Miracle himself gets a Blink. Perhaps, and then the next big timing is like the Blink plus Desolator on the TA.
Yeah.
So it's mid game oriented, whereas Imperial. It can do perhaps a little more in the early game if Pudge gets rolling, but not easy by any means. Ooh, excuse me, Fanta coming back up. Both teams are very reliant on their Blink Dagger, so like the Axe as well, he's kind of the tempo controller on the side of Imperial as well, so getting his Blink Dagger up could be big. 5 seconds.
Remaining. Why would you pick up Centaur first? Okay. Player with the most D wards by 15 minutes, Kuro?
Be Bulba more likely, by Bulba or Ryze, I guess. Depends which team.
We're going for Bulba.
Yeah, Bulba's he's a Dota nerd.
Total number of trees destroyed. We have no Timber Saw in the game.
What a
people
great question.
Eat Tango, so it's just going to be 0 to 50.
So 10 heroes, that they each what? They each go 4 apiece? That's 40. Will it be? It might be over 50 if there's 3 heroes that get 2 sets.
But there's no spells that destroy trees.
TPs could.
TPs could.
I feel like the 51 is a little... It's one of the first two. I don't know which. But...
Well, we're going for this one. We're going for a lot of TPs into trees.
Yeah, TPs into trees. That's like 2 trees on a TP. It is 30 minutes, so yeah, I think 51 is big.
0 to 2 project kills?
Yeah, I guess
so. I haven't been wrong with that one yet,
Why not?
Total number of teleport stuns by 25 minutes.
Oh,
there's a lot. There's a few disables.
I'll leave that one up to you.
One or two, one. We're going for one.
It'd be 0, 1, or 2, I think.
Yeah.
I don't see it being like 3+. I think 0 or 1 is the good number to go for.
We're going for 1. Okay, got that going for us. Waiting for the teams to give the ready sign. Let's take a look at who's playing what. We have Ace, of course, on his Centaur, Ryze on the Dazzle, Axe by Hester Joe, Baby Knight on the OD, and Pudge by Noya. That's everybody on the side of Imperial, and then on the side of Team Liquid, Matuma Man on, as you mentioned, is one of his famous heroes, Lifestealer. Nice set as well. Miracle Templar Assassin, we got Bulba on the Disruptor, Mind Control on the Slardar, and Kuroki on the Ogre Mage. That is everybody, and we are paused, and we do not know why. Toilet.
WC.
Yep.
And they're back.
And they're
good
back.
Timing, as we finish our intros. So,
yep.
Probably standard lanes coming out from the two teams. Don't expect anything crazy here. I guess big questions are whether Mind Control even tries to lane or just goes straight jungle with an Iron Talon. I'd almost suggest, given some of his recent games, that he may just go Iron Talon level 1 and say, screw it, I don't want to go to lane. I'd rather just Iron Talon jungle.
Mm-hmm.
And on the Imperial side, it's the act whether he actually tries to lane or just goes Iron Talon jungle himself. And that kind of is more a question as to how much help he's going to get. Is Pudge going to be helping the bottom lane? Is Dazzle, or is Dazzle just helping up the top lane?
This Pudge was, by the way, he was so fast. Nope. Didn't get scouted out, got this ward out. I don't think they'll know it's there because Bulba thinks he cleared the area. Maybe. Well,
TP in and get there in time, so.
That's pretty nice, nice rotation. Okay. So, for Imperial, I feel like the pressure's on them. In terms of performing, they have to make this Centaur work. We saw it already earlier today where the Centaur was just a big ass meat shield, but nobody was hitting the shield.
Yep, that's kind of what seems to be the a trend now with the Centaur pick for them. Like, teams have seen it. It's no longer a surprise. Teams almost want them to play the Centaur in some games. And
I mean, if you're a Tuberman, you want to hit the Centaur. It heals you.
That's true. If you ever get low, just turn and hit him. But you also just do so much reckless damage to him because of the bonus damage there.
Are you going for an entire different item build if you know that there's a lifesteal in your game for your Centaur?
Possibly. I feel like...
Whoa!
It's already 18?
It's already 18!
Whoa, where are those 18 trees destroyed?
How do we see it?
I mean, I guess there were some TPs out at level 1, but they wouldn't have killed that many trees.
TP went here, no trees there.
Where did the Pudge TP? The TP bottom or mid?
Okay, that's 4? Right?
18 trees chopped down. I don't know about that. Volvo mats.
How did that happen?
Well, I'm feeling better about our guess now. It definitely won't be the zero number.
That's, wow.
Oh, Axe is Iron Talon. He's probably just spamming it. Did Slada also have Iron Talon?
Hello.
Oh yeah, there we go. What about Slada?
Stop doing that! Joe, please!
No, the window's pretty good. It was like 51 to like 150.
175,
yeah. 175.
Oh, okay.
I think Slaughter and Axe are just spamming Iron Talon. What kind of happened?
Oh, Slaughter doesn't,
no,
have,
he doesn't
one.
Have one. He's actually laning, so he's feeling good about his chances up there.
Okay, so they leave the bottom lane open. This means Lifestealer is free farming. They get Ogre Mage visiting them in the jungle, but I don't think he's able to do anything at all. And with level 1 hook, it's just not that great.
Yep. Not good. He's not going to win this right-click battle. Kuru takes...
He is not.
Literally no damage there. That was not a good idea for Noi to even try and right... I mean, cancel the clarity, sure, but then as soon as you cancel it, run the hell away. Don't stand your ground and keep trying to fight him. Okay.
How do you feel this mid lane is going to go? Miracle versus... Miracle Templar Assassin versus Baby Knight OD.
TA Light Edge is Miracle as well, so I think Miracle just mechanically is going to be the stronger player. Baby Knight's much more like a strategic player in the mid lane. He's very consistent, but I think Miracle's a player who will win this matchup against him because of hero and just mechanic.
Fair enough. Let's see if that will come true. So far, so good though. It is indeed 9-4 for the Templar Assassin and 5-2 for the OD.
Yep. Hugged in the neighborhood, but again, this Sogus just set up camp. He knows that Axe kind of wants to jungle, so he's trying to get it annoying up there, but Axe has now shown himself bottom, so looks like that'll lead to Ogre either helping out mid lane or even rotating down bottom. He needs to find a new place to make himself handy.
I thought the Axe versus Lifestealer was pretty decent.
Pretty decent, yeah. It's the disruptor factor, I guess, where he can kind of zone you out pretty well just by himself, and Axe is one of those heroes that the decision whether to go to the offlane or go jungle isn't all about whether you're going to get zoned from the offlane, because you farm just as fast, if not faster, in the jungle. So sometimes you just say, I'm going to go jungle just because I know it's going to work out fine.
This is going very fast.
It's at 30 minutes, too. Don't worry, they're not going to keep buying Tengos and chopping down.
I hope not.
There's no Timber Stall, you know. How many trees on the Dota map actually go down? I'm glad we didn't choose. If we chose 0 to 51, we would have looked like idiots, though. So.
Lost by 3 minutes.
Yeah.
Well,
I somehow didn't think about Crawling Blade. I don't know why about for that. For 9 talent.
Yeah, but even if you do, you're not going to clear every tree.
Yeah. And after like the early jungling stage, you stop seeing it, chop down trees. But yeah, it's also Matu with a Crawling Blade, so he'll be chopping down trees here and there. It's one of those things a lot of carry players just kind of spam the item just to make paths through the jungle or even just to get their APM going, keep their fingers warm.
Yeah, that actually makes sense. Makes a lot of sense. Actually, no, he has to now constantly use his Iron Talon on creeps rather than on trees. So we're good there.
Yeah, that's pretty good there. Using on trees doesn't give you the long cooldown, though. You use it on a tree, it's short cooldown.
He got this kill. Doesn't look like it.
Ow.
He's punishing Baby Knight.
Oh, he's level 2 now. I think they can actually kill him.
Yeah?
Refraction will get kicked off real fast. He's
gonna just hold his ground and fight. Miracle realizes he hasn't really got a good escape plan. So
he can get a kill too! Oh my god, they get the first blood on Miracle. Sure, I mean he dies, but Miracle getting first blood is definitely very nice. Baby Knight will end up dropping as well. Another kill going away of Team Liquid. Maybe he has a joke and turn this around. He will indeed with the help of Rise. So 2 for 2. But it was Miracle that got the first blood credit.
Yep. And first blood means even more gold in his pocket, so even better kill because of that.
That went a little bit different than what Imperial was intending to have happen. I mean, that's just Pudge being very squishy. It was a level 2, so...
Yeah. One armor hero against a TA, physical damage.
Yeah, good luck with that.
Not gonna end well for you. Matu free farming away, his life still are gonna be having a happy time.
Mm-hmm.
Phase, Blightstone, all the basic items you need as a lifestealer just to function, and no one can really come. Axe can't really come for this lane now that lifestealer is going to be level 6 with the basic items he needs to zone out here.
Okay, well, Wilbur roaming around as well, level 4 for him right now. Doing pretty decent. Able to get his levels on the creeps. In the meantime, there's an ogre just punching Hester Joe, and actually, Kuroki has to be very careful. There's a call available. And he's standing in rock as well, getting hooked, and that is a dead Ogre Magi.
Yep.
And they let Noria get the kill.
Okay for him. Axe will hit level 6 off of this. Curious to see if he just focuses entirely on farming up a Blink Dagger, or if maybe he looks to smoke with a teammate. Because you've got Stampede on your team, you can actually Stampede in and use the Axe to fight around the level 6 timing, rather than having to wait entirely for the Blink Dagger. I think Imperial want to play a little bit more aggressive as opposed to just playing pure passive farming mode.
I think that's what that previous game with the Centaur taught them, if anything.
Yep.
We gotta keep moving, gotta keep being aggressive and being the one that is making the plays and determining the tempo. And I say that, maybe Knight's actually having a little bit of an issue here. He uses Astral, he does get 2 teleports to help him out. One hooks him away out of danger, the other heals him up. Soon.
Oh, he's side-blading off of the Night Creep. That's so good from Miracle.
Very nice. Nice Astral as well, keeping Noya safe. Still looking for the side-blades from Miracle there, but nobody will actually die. The attempts were made, though, and another teleport made as Hester Joe comes back into the jungle. Astral is actually pretty good to combine with the Axe, but the stun will make sure he won't get the call-off. Maybe the body block Rise? Looking for that body block, gets it as well. Oh, the call is still off though. And he's not getting it in mind control now. Coming in, has got the crush on 2, gets a dazzle then first. He does have the grade for himself. But I don't think that's gonna make a difference. He does not have a heal available, throws out his last bit of mana. Oh my god, they let him live.
Didn't want to chase that one, and they didn't have any real good range damage to chase him down with. The ignite had worn off at that point, so.
Yeah.
All
very
right.
Lucky for Ryze, I feel. But good for Imperial. Again, nobody dies.
Yeah, nobody dies. It is still Matu free farm. It's like a Centaur versus Lifesteal free farm. So you can't just say, oh, Lifesteal's free farming. It's bad for Imperial. Because they've got their Centaur free farming, which is, for them, it's always the game plan. They like having this Centaur free farm away. They don't worry too much about trading farm, even when it's a traditional carry, like a Lifesteal farming against their Centaur. They say, nope, this is our plan. This is what we want to do. So the equal trades in mid lane basically means that as far as Imperial are concerned, their draft is kind of going how they want it to be going. From a kind of my perspective, I'm not sold that the carry Centaur is going to work as well this game as it has other games.
It's going to be a tough one for sure. So looking at Imperial, they got that axe, the fairly greedy axe if you put the Pudge down bottom, but... Yeah, Axe is getting his levels, he is getting his farm, he is focusing on Blink Dagger. What?
Kuro got a D ward, he's winning the D ward battle.
Oh, was that it?
Yeah.
Oh.
You even said Kuro, and I told you to think it.
It's okay. I believe Boba's not gonna let me down.
Don't worry, yeah, we still got time.
How long do we have?
10-15. Okay.
Oh, 5-6 minutes.
Yeah.
Normally you don't expect a melee hero to be ward.
Yeah, normally that is indeed the case, but he has the wards giving Bulba the freedom to go for some other items, including the Windlace. They'd know. Baby and I drew on the minimap. They're very well aware there's two people sitting right next to his tier 1 tower. Nice scan as well from the Radiant. They know that the OD is there. Well, they knew that the OD was there, and then the OD came up for the match.
Well, both teams seemed to realize exactly what was going on.
Yep, there was a stampede in. They want to go for the Slardar. Mind control. Oh, he gets a crush up before the Centaur does, and that should be enough for him to get out. Oh, fortunate. Unfortunate for Imperial.
Unfortunate, but also misexecution.
Yeah.
You have to pre-cast your stun. So Slardar stun has a shorter cast time than Centaur's, but you make up for that by starting your path before the Astral Edge. Nice hook for Bulba. We'll still get a kill from Matu, and Matu thinks about turning to 2, but knows there's a grave, so he's not going to go diving for that.
Mm-hmm. In the meantime, was that all the kills that happened? I guess so.
One for one
this
there.
Is just runes picked up. Okay. Miracle. He's going to find himself maybe in a bit of trouble, but... Oh. What's he doing? He doesn't have a TP. I guess he still didn't, they didn't think that they see him, which they didn't, so it's all good. Two towers already down on the side of Imperial. It seems like Team Liquid is doing quite okay on lanes as well. Surely Imperial will feel comfortable with their Centaur Warrunner free farming, but at some point, and at what point, do they have to start worrying about Team Liquid?
I think it's a very early point when they start getting probably the Blink Dagger on the Slardar. They can play very fast tempo. They'll just start blinking around, getting kills with the Infest Bomb. At that point, Lifesteal is going to have at least an Echo Saber, which will go with his Armlet, maybe even the Working towards a Desolator. It's going to be very scary to deal with. So, it's going to, for now, be kind of a slow pace from Liquid. They'll take what kills they can get with Matu getting involved. But more than anything, they just want to get some objective towers to build towards those Blink Daggers.
Oh, Goya, very close, but misses indeed. In the meantime, open wounds up top. Wants to go for the OD, realizing that there's a lot of people behind there, and the Stampede is used, but Tumba Man does have an effect. But there is first an Astral Imprisonment, just trying to get away afterwards. In the meantime, it is Ogre Magi that is found, and Lifesteal is sitting in one of the Dire Creeps, and they know.
They know, but I think killing it's just not possible at this point.
They just want to go for the tower, but there will be another rage up once the Lifesteal jumps out.
Yep.
And better yet, he can at some point just control and run away, but...
Okay.
This works,
they managed
too.
To get the Lifesteal creep in front with some nice lane manipulation, but ultimately just not like he had another rage. Killing him wasn't really possible. He used the Stampede already. Let's try and take this top tier 1 tower, but Liquid are there, ready to maybe pounce.
Yeah, there's a Blink Dagger up on Miracle. He's looking for a target. In comes a Glimpse, Static Storm, Static Field, Kinetic Field. There you go. Astral Joe's just getting a little bit of a rest, but Namatuma comes in. Astral will keep him safe for a little while longer. But how long will it actually last? Not very long, that's for sure. The Disruptor actually is the last
so fast. Jeez.
Yeah, I was a little bit too much there as Ryze. He might have to grave himself. He did grave himself. And there comes the Ignite, though, and that should be enough to kill him. Two kills are ready for Team Liquid as Imperial is on the run. Ace healing up Batuma Man with his always life that he has, and the rest teleports out. Clever, because in terms of control for teleports, there is not that much that was still available. It was not already used. I think Liquid is doing pretty well for themselves.
Absolutely. Their carries are farming better, they're finding the key kills. Slider's not doing amazing by any means, but he's on par with the Axe as far as farm goes. They'll hit a similar blink timing at this rate, and you're not expecting maybe 13-minute blink anyways on your offlane Slider. He didn't get much help this game, he was just off on his own, so considering he actually contested the lane, went for the poor man shield build, this has been a very good showing from Mike control here.
Yeah.
Liquid as a whole are doing well. They're taking towers and objectives. They're going to hit the Blink Dagger timings, and they can actually snowball super hard with a Blink Slardar now.
They do have a Blink Dagger on the Axe now. Imperial does. That is, and that's their first step to making a difference. But Tumbleman is getting all the D wards?
I guess he just KS'd them with his Iron Talon. It looked like he was around when they were pushing. I don't think anyone was going to predict that one.
Oh. I guess, you know. Oh. Two observers. Ouch.
The Imperial had thrown off a bit, perhaps, communicating.
Yeah.
Not as well as they maybe normally would. Well, Liquid.
There's
They'll
a
be feeling
dragon.
Good about this game.
This is the sword that I use as well. It's pretty good.
That's a good looking Stardust then.
Yeah.
The key thing being that it hides most of his model.
Yeah. That seems to be the common theme for a starter.
Yeah, a good starter set cover up as much as there as possible.
It's been an entire different skin. Okay. Bulba is the bait.
Yep.
We got TA backing up. I mean, Bulba is a fairly obvious bait, I guess, because the rest is missing from the map. There's a TA backing him up. Ogre and an infested Slardar. So let's see what they can do. They want to force this out.
They find a pickoff. They take back a little bit here, but they'll still be in the neighborhood. And there's that Slardar infest. Smoke up from Liquid. They are looking to make a play, find some openings. There's a lot of safe though with Astral as well as Grave on the dive side.
They find themselves the OD first. He drops, but the axe comes into the call. He hits it on three, has to joke, gets the spins going. That is one dunk on the Ogre Mech that is about to die there as well. In the meantime, Templar Assassin zoom which he can, but the Grave is there, making sure that Pike doesn't die for the moment. In comes a blink and the call again from Hestajo. This blink doing wonders. And it is Imperial that has only lost, well, it's 3-for-3 right now. They will lose another one though as Microtrol gets the last hit there too. Now Ace, last one alive for his team. Does he actually want to fight Matuma Man is the question. I don't think he does.
Matu's thinking about it. He's like, I think I can get this kill. I'm not really sure. Can I armor toggle it? Can I not? He's got open wounds. He can feast off the Centaur, but you don't verse Centaur very often in Pro Dota, and that's where I think Matu just had... I think he honestly just had no idea if he could get that kill or not, and just decided, why risk it? It's not worth dying for to give Centaur a kill there, and he probably knew best if he could get the kill, so... He backs off, and it's a 4-for-3. Very messy fight. OD was going up the ramp by himself. His teammates who were smoked were off to the right, so he wasn't in range for the Grave, and he couldn't Astral himself. It was just a bit of mispositioning on his part, and unfortunately that means Imperial have a slightly worse team fight. It was a great initiation from Axe, followed up by the Central Stun, but not enough for Imperial in the end.
Not enough indeed, and Liquid, they haven't lost a single tower yet. All the tier 1s are down on the side of Imperial, and it's tier 2s that they want next. It feels like they're very safe. I mean, everybody has seen all the hate that Liquid's been getting lately, and it seems like they really just want to make sure that they're doing everything right. They're really careful, yet calculated. It's looking pretty good. They're on the same page. It's a good opening.
Yep. It's a very stable draft too. You have a very clear game plan with the timings around the Slardar blink, around the synergy between the Slardar and the Lifestealer. The TA, perhaps has some overlap where it's just another damage to do more physical damage, but it makes their plan very clear. Lots of physical damage, lots of blink initiations, Rosh control, being able to take down objectives as well, following the kills because of the Lifestealer as well as TA's ability to hit buildings very well, so... Very clear overall game plan from the side of Liquid.
Yeah, Roshan is up now as well, and Team Liquid has a good way of taking Roshan, but they will need some pickups before they get it. It looks like they're gonna get one right now. Oh, I say that, but Astro comes in with the call. It might be enough to save the OD, but no, it's not. The glimpse is there, and now Axe is trying to get himself out. Astro is taking a lot of damage. He's gonna try to teleport out there. Grave on Rise as well. He is living. The punch of it is the other one to die. There still goes the Dazzle, no surprise there. And they actually blink in and crush. But Miracle, yeah, he's going to be the one to get the triple kill there. Rather than
that's a Vanguard Hood Centaur. He looked like paper against that physical damage.
Oh, he just melted.
That's why I feel like Centaur, this is a game where you need a 4-staff and a Blink Dagger because you've got to kite the physical damage. And this carry-style Centaur, it's the classic Imperial. You see Centaur and you think, this, you know exactly what they're going to do. And it's just bloody annoying to deal with, but this is one of those games where it's been hard counting. This draft
as a whole just destroys him.
And they could have stomped it around with the last pick, perhaps, yeah. But they chose not to, and the Axe is having some nice calls, though. Hasuho is doing a good job with that, but...
I mean, that could be a Centaur. It could just be an offlane Centaur initiating fights with a Blink Stun instead of the Axe Blink Call. It's not as good as an Axe, because it's got a bit of a wind-up and cast time to it, and it just doesn't have the best follow-up.
Yeah, and it doesn't farm as fast, perhaps, either.
Yeah, absolutely. So, it wouldn't have been as good of an offlaner, but they could have had a much better overall draft than safe lane farmer, I feel. Picking something, I don't know, again, like I mentioned, the Morphling, the Terrorblade, something with high armor, something that can sustain against the physical damage, or be elusive, survive.
Yep, that's all they need to do, be elusive and survive. That doesn't sound like a winning strategy.
I mean, you push lanes, like that's what Morphling and Terrorblade, it's like you stay alive, don't get ganked, and push lane. Morphling, I think, would have been like a ideal fifth pick for them, but it's not an Imperial hero. These guys are sticking to their guns, which definitely can respect, and you don't want to suddenly be second-guessing yourself in an important event like a Major's Qualifier, like changing all your stats. Like, you pick that center to be safe lane, stick to it, I guess, was their logic.
Yeah.
They're just going to make this draft work now. They're going to smoke up and look for their next play, their next maneuver. They're heading down bottom by himself, actually. Has picked up a plate mail, so already we're seeing the change in item build from Ace. Not going in. Normally this is where it goes for the heart. Instead, he's picked up a plate mail, so...
Need some armor.
Spring Shivers,
it.
I'd say, is probably your best bet. Even the casual plate mail is fine.
Oh, they know that there are people there, but this is a haste attempt for Assassin. And in comes the Blink Crush. Doesn't actually hit anybody. Has to Joe. Looking for a jump in as well. Ace follow up on the Axe, and that is a Templar Assassin down, so they can do that. There was no counter initiation from Liquid right now.
I mean, Mind Control had already used his Blink Crush, so that was on cooldown. That was absolutely miracles. Perhaps slight mistake going back in, but now Noyes can make mistakes.
Oh, a pretty big one too! This will be one that costs his life.
Yep.
Two for two, one for one, rather. Two heroes died, definitely in favor of Imperial though, but it is actually Team Liquid that wants to go in again. In comes the Axe, looking for the call, nice Static Storm, hits up on two heroes. We can't really do that much anymore. Now Akulaman looking for some kills, almost finds it on Head to Joe, decides not to chase that down, but the glimpse is there, and the Crush actually hits on three as well. Akulaman continues eating up heroes, he got himself a double kill, will lose his Aegis. Might still be in time for the triple kill if he gets a kill on the Central Warrunner. Central doesn't have a stun anymore, and that is indeed a triple kill for Matumaman. Now looking for another one. It won't get an ultra kill, but there will be four people dead on the side of Imperial, and I say four, but I mean, Noya was dead at the start. As you see, he was already back, so five for just one.
Five for the TA and then Aegis, but that's how you use an Aegis. You win a team fight, get a team wipe. Yep. That's the ideal way to go through that. And well, it's going to be an objective to follow it up. The Desolator on Miracle make this tier 2 tower go down very quickly. And the tier 2 tower up top.
Yep, that's the last two outer towers that Imperial has to offer. After that, Liquid is going to need to try and go high ground already. We're only 22 minutes into the game. Miracle does get a blink away. Tower will get denied at least. That's something that Imperial can... I say that.
Miracle
is ready to take that
confidently.
One. That's okay as well. More gold into the pockets of Team Liquid.
And his BKB finished after that ancient camp, though. So. We'll see item progression galore on the Liquid side. Matu doesn't have to go for the Desolator himself. He can go into the Basher because the Desolator's on the TA. They've got lots of minus some already. And this is just extra lockdown. Perhaps we see an AC on him if he wants to, but... not sure that's a necessary item. The lockdown's the key thing, because when he goes on someone, often the Stampede will pull him out and save their life.
I feel like the impact of the Pudge is not really there, unfortunately.
No, it's been a pretty quiet game from Noy. I mean, he's moved around, he's been aggressive, but it's always been like a trade where he dies, maybe a teammate dies, and they get one kill. It always feels like a bad trade.
How does this work?
Trade.
He's got 3 kills, 7 assists,
and
but they only have 9 kills.
I don't know. I've been in a few games recently. There wasn't any hero denied this game.
I don't think so.
I don't know. Baldwin math again.
God.
Just like the tree counting. I don't trust Valve with that counting system.
Let's see how the trees are looking, guys. 110!
I got 6 minutes to go. We should be good.
I think we are good, yeah.
Not many more trees should go down, you know. The Falling Blade chopping is stopped. Maybe some TP scrolls here or there will break a few, but that's bad.
Infest. Into the slaughter we go again. Mind control. Can we jump on the right target? Yes, he can! Hello, Centaur! Oh my god, look at how far he dies! They don't even have the... Oh!
Ignite, not okay, nothing there.
No, oh, we, I was gonna say it's okay, I was like, but they're not. Oh, that side blade as well! The TKP is also doing one, that's a blade mill! Just, actually, the blade mill still did quite hurt quite a bit, but that's physical damage going through. Three dead so far on Imperial. Baby Knight puts himself under for the moment. There's the amount of super blood, and he jump out of time. No, he cannot. He'll die. That's a team wipe. That is 24 minutes in, and Team Liquid is looking very dominant and all on the same page.
Outdrafted.
Outdrafted?
Yeah, absolutely. Not Liquid played it well. They've I think, outplayed them as well. I mean,
yeah.
Miracle winning the mid lane. They made some really good movements around the map, some great static stones from Bulba. He's also always... The Stampede's not been an effective save and escape because Bulba's always glitched them back in as well. So we're seeing Liquid play their draft really well and play well together as a team, but
yeah.
The draft to me is still the biggest point. I think the core central of this game, the carry central,
this is great. You can't pick it up.
Doesn't
first.
Work.
It's just not possible.
I don't know, I feel like Imperial, they had the opportunity to change it too. Come fifth pick, they could have said, look, I know maybe Hesajo's never played Centaur in a competitive game. At that point, you'd say, it doesn't matter, we lose this game on draft if we run carry Centaur. We have to run offlane Centaur. And if you're an offlaner and you haven't played Centaur in a pro game, it's not too hard to suddenly play it because it's the same as playing like a slaughter or something. You blink, you stun. You initiate a fight. It's a very similar concept.
Blink, you stun. That's what happens.
Mind control is showing you how you do it.
Yeah.
That's how you play Centaur.
And even Punch is actually pretty nice to have when you're playing Life Stealer. They will get the kill on Life Stealer finally, though. But that is a godlike streak going to Ace. Now, how is he going to transition that gold into damage? Because that's his problem,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
that's his main problem.
He got the Lotus Orb. I guess to get rid of the amp damage, he wanted the Lotus Orb. And
yeah.
It gives him, it's the plate mail item, so it gives him armor. But I think he just goes for a shiv. I think he gets more armor. Just keep getting armor. Get a shivers now. He doesn't want to get it raw HP, because that's what the Life Stealer wants him to do. So the Heart of Tarrasque is always going to be a bad item.
Yeah.
Get
all the armor items.
Shiver's Guard is your next item, and then after that, AC, get the Shiver's Energy, I don't know.
That's
a bit too overkill and gimmicky, but
well,
who knows.
Nobody else on his team would build the AC, I guess. And
yeah.
They kind of do need one against all this armor reduction.
Yeah. I've got some bonus armor from the Weave of Dazzle, but it's still, still tricky.
Well, Roshan is back up again. At least Liquid will see that soon, as they have the trap down.
Good news for them as far as ending this game goes, and they're up that lane of racks, ready to take another, I imagine, with a good fight.
Yeah.
They've got an AC coming on Miracle, it looks like. Yep, AC recipe.
They do indeed. Centaur, teleporting home. He has to run. He's sitting on 2100 life, but it doesn't really matter how much life he has at this point. He still dies so fast. Like, earlier on, we saw the Lifestealer jump in with the Slardar and one of the supports, and they didn't even have the minus armor, and they almost killed him anyway.
Yeah, even with without the amp, the physical damage is easily high enough that killing tanky centaurs and ODs isn't a problem. They're not reliant on the amp damage. The amp damage just means they die perhaps twice as fast, but the difference between killing a hero in a second and a half or 3 seconds. The AC now kicks in, so, well, Imperial there, kind of faking out, testing the waters around this Roshan. They know it's up. They don't want to go in and get caught. They're hoping that maybe they can catch Liquid inside the pit, but that is not where Liquid are right now.
No, and Imperial is kind of showing that they are not anywhere else.
Liquid see no one defending mid, so they realize that some kind of weird play is going on where they're about to get smoke wrapped around, or the opponents are at Roshan, and they're going to force them back to base. They force the top lane. They're going to make sure that Imperial cannot go for Roshan and also cannot flank them without coming back to defend.
Yep. That is already some teleport there. Axe looking for the blink in. A Miracle. Miracle's already gone, though, and actually...
Just one hit off and blinks out.
Yeah, just blinked out. Gets astrolled, actually, by his teammate. He didn't even blink up. just get set up to death. That was a bit unfortunate. And buys back as well, but the rest already GG. It's out. That is not end well. I think he tried to astral imprison the Templar assassin.
Yeah. TA made a nice play, like hit the axe, had the refraction up so he could still blink away and kited him around a bit.
Oh! That will cause some problems in the Valve rankings.
Volvo, please fix.
The Volvo, please fix, because that is not how things are supposed to go.
I guess they canceled the GG, I don't know.
Yeah. That was it for me.